Salam alaikum, William Safir, Atlanta, Georgia. Please introduce yourself and where you're calling from.
Assalamu alaikum, this is Naja and Aretha from Brooklyn, New York.
Wa alaikum salam, Naja and Aretha. How are you both?
Doing well.
Good, alhamdulillah. Please
Assalamu
introduce.
alaikum,
Wa
this
alaikum
is
salam.
Abdul Alim from Markham, Ontario.
Abdul Alim, wa alaikum salam. How are you, brother?
Alhamdulillah,
Good.
alhamdulillah, rabbil alamin. How
Good
are
to
you?
see you. Good to see you. I'm doing great. Alhamdulillah.
Okay.
Assalamu alaikum, Arlene Elamine, Minneapolis, Minnesota.
Wa alaikum salam, Arlene. How are you today?
Alhamdulillah, and yourself?
Doing good, thank you. All right, just keep introducing yourself and where you're calling from.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
Saheed Mujahid, Bakersfield, California.
Shaheed, Shaheed.
Pleasure to see you, brother.
Yeah, good to see you always, man.
It's
For
a
real,
true
for real.
brother,
Yes,
true
sir.
brother.
Indeed, indeed.
Glad to be in the house.
Yes, sir. Alhamdulillah. Keep it coming, please. Introduce yourself and where you're calling from.
Assalamu alaikum. Ezekiel Abdullah from Atlanta, Georgia.
Wa alaikum salam, Ezekiel. And how are you, my brother?
I'm good. Alhamdulillah. How about Safiya?
I'm doing good. Alhamdulillah. Thank you, brother.
Good evening. It's Jennifer Hall from Cleveland, Ohio.
Good evening, Jennifer. And how are you today?
I'm great. How are you doing?
I'm doing good. Thank you. Good to see you.
Good to see you as well.
Yeah, alhamdulillah. Keep it coming. Please introduce yourself and where you're calling from. We have a lot of very, very important information we're going to share with you this evening. So be sure to introduce yourself when we get the show on the road. Introduce yourself and where you're calling from, please. As we're waiting for everyone to come on board, as you come on, please introduce yourself and where you're calling from. We're going to be talking about Imam W. Deen Mohammed and his contributions, as well as, and leading up to that, I'll share a few words about my experience that led up to his jumping into his mission and the Nation of Islam. And he, of course, he was a very integral part of that. But please introduce yourself if you haven't done so, and where you're calling from. I'm seeing some familiar names. I'm seeing Yahya and Winona and Jesse.
Jesse from Raleigh.
Yes, sir. Jesse, assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum.
How you doing, brother?
Good, alhamdulillah.
Good. All right, keep it coming. Introduce yourself and where you're calling from.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
Majid.
Wa alaikum salam.
How are
go ahead.
You?
I'm good, alhamdulillah.
Glad to see you. Glad to be here.
How's the weather in Southern Cal?
It is overcast. Looks like it's going to rain, and has looked like that all morning.
Wow.
But it's been beautiful the last few days.
Good.
Yeah.
All right, alhamdulillah. If you see Imam Ron, give him
I certainly shall.
Okay, keep it coming. Please introduce yourself and where you're calling from.
I'm Salih from New York.
Wa alaikum salam, Salih. And how are you?
Alhamdulillah, brother. How are you?
Good. I'm doing good. Thank you. Keep it coming. Introduce yourself, please.
Salam alaikum. I mean, Sharif, Charlotte, North Carolina.
Wa alaikum salam, Amin. How are you?
I got a little guest tonight.
Ah, there she is. How are you?
Good.
What's your name?
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam. Beautiful. Good. Good to see you. Been asking about you. Your grandpa tell you? Okay. All right. Keep it coming. Please introduce yourself and where you're calling from.
Salam alaikum. This is Shafika Abdullah from Atlanta, Georgia.
Wa alaikum salam. Shafika sounds like you glad to be from Atlanta, Georgia.
I am so thankful to be alive and mentally able.
Yes,
thank
yes,
you.
Yes.
How are
awesome.
You?
I'm doing great, alhamdulillah.
Wonderful.
Good.
No, why? No, ma'am.
You don't want to?
No,
all right, introduce yourself and where you're calling from, please. Keep it coming.
Assalamu alaikum, Sophia from Bermuda.
Wa alaikum salam, Sophia. And how are you?
Alhamdulillah, I'm good. How are you?
I'm doing good.
Assalamu alaikum, Wali Udin Sabir.
Wa alaikum salam. Wa alaikum salam, Wali. And how are you, my brother?
I'm great. How are you?
Good. Something look like you're rolling, brother.
Yeah, well, I am.
All right, alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah. Yeah. Be safe out there. All right.
Yes, sir.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaykum salam.
Muhammad Alim Ali, El Sobrante, San Francisco area.
Muhammad, how you doing, my brother?
Alhamdulillah, I'm doing good. Got my cap on, man.
Yeah, I see.
Yeah. Praise be to Allah.
All good. Right. Yeah. Good, good, good. Alhamdulillah. All right, keep it coming, please. Introduce yourself and where you call it from. You haven't done so yet.
Yahya Hussain, Atlanta, Georgia.
Yahya, assalamu alaikum. How you doing, brother?
Alhamdulillah, holding on, hanging on, hoping and praying, running on faith and teams.
Oh, yes, sir. Yes, sir. Nothing but prayer and hope. That's, as a matter of fact, leave off the hope part. Just do it to be able to pray in part.
I'm praying and praying.
There you go. There you go. The praying and acting, right? Alhamdulillah. Keep it coming, please. Introduce yourself and where you're calling from.
Assalamu alaikum. Tanya from the UK.
Wa alaikum salam, Tanya. And how are you?
Alhamdulillah. Okay. I'm good. Good. Can't good, complain.
Good, 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 good. How's the weather in the UK right now?
Oh, it's we're getting some hot sun. So
hot. Okay.
Alhamdulillah for that. Because you know yeah. The UK don't get much of it.
That's right. That's right. That's right. All right. We're good. Alhamdulillah. All right, keep coming, please introduce yourself. Where are you calling from?
Brother Fahim, River Cliff, Georgia.
Fahim, assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam. Trying to eat some pizza, man.
Yes, sir, alhamdulillah. All right, keep it coming. Introduce yourself and where you're calling from. Like I see the big D checking in.
All right. Assalamu alaikum. This is Brother Mahir L. calling in from Dallas.
Wa alaikum salam, Mahir. How are you, my brother?
Alhamdulillah.
Good to see you, man.
Yes, sir.
Keep it coming, please. Introduce yourself and where you're calling from. All right. If no one else is coming forth, people are still coming on board, but let me just share some words in the way of introduction. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Instructor is going to share with us something I think is very, very important for us to keep not only reminded, but anchored in what we've been blessed with for what, 33 years or more, actually, of Imam W. Deen Mohammed's presence and sharing with us his, Allah has blessed him in terms of insight and just readiness to. Take us to the, right to the door of us being able to grow and evolve based upon the fitrah and our relationship with it by introducing us to the Quran and following in his father's leadership like I don't think anybody else could. And he was just a natural part of the evolutionary process. And I became a part of the community in 1968. And at that time, I was about 20 years old, very young man, still in college at the time. But I was deeply involved in what was called back then the revolutionary movement, the Black Power movement. And the Honorable Elijah Muhammad really attracted me because I found out that all of the talk that I was hearing from, you know, all of the so-called Black Power advocates, all of them, you know, I didn't know anything about the Nation of Islam at the time, but I kept hearing the talk about owning land, businesses, doing for ourselves, reaching back to our roots in Africa. I started hearing things that, and I couldn't trace the root of it. When I heard that all of what they were giving as if it was their own, they had actually gotten from Elijah Muhammad without giving him credit. And so I began my association and got very eager in that association, again, in 1968. And so for 7 years, I was exposed to one who I considered probably made one of the, if not the biggest impact on humanity in the 21st century. He actually laid the way, paved the way, for Imam W. Deen Muhammad, what we see happening with Minister Farrakhan and how he's, what he's done in terms of his contribution that he's made, what he did to prepare and mold and shape and motivate the likes of Muhammad Ali, Malcolm. The list goes on and on and on. But those are some of the more prominent names that come to mind right away. But they have a very profound impact on a number of lives that I witnessed. And for me, I saw lives changed, you know, coming from a background myself in a very, backwards, a very demoralized, a very substandard level of living in terms of what was available to human beings back when I was a kid growing up back in Watts. It was an environment that was hurtful. You know, it was one that was demoralizing. It was one that made you, I know it certainly made me as a young man, it made me dig deep and wonder and about what was this life all about, and there had to be some hope somewhere. Brother mentioned hope a little while ago, and I just couldn't see it. You know, I didn't see any leadership anywhere as a kid, and I struck out on my own to try to raise some consciousness in the community, and I didn't see any real leadership until I came across Elijah Muhammed. You know. And when he emerged in my mind, in my consciousness, as a real leader and a figure. Let me just share this while we're waiting on our dear beloved international instructor, Benjamin Blau. When I was thinking about Elijah Muhammed as a human being, as a person, it was so much that came to mind. I just made a list. Let me just share with you some of the words that came to mind when I was thinking about his character, what Allah put in him, and how he impacted my young mind. I just read the words. I won't go into any length of sharing my thoughts, but in terms of leadership and courage and sincerity, his fitra-based logic, his common sense, his moral strength, his trustworthiness, his thinking ability, very deep thinker, his cosmic reach. Yes, Elijah Muhammed has some deep cosmic reach. He was a family man by far. He introduced us to nutrition and fasting like I had never been introduced before at all on anything that came close to that. You know, his phenomenal book, How to Eat to Live. His terms of his global consciousness, how he lifted that. His humility. I actually met him in person. If I have time, I'll share that experience with you. His strength. He was a very little man physically, but he was a giant. He was a giant in terms of his impact and his humanity. His strength, his dignity. He was a very dignified person. He was very extremely wise. He was the economic genius. His program of do for self was virtually unmatched during the day, especially for people like us as African Americans. And you know, coming up through the 30s and the 40s and 50s into the 60s, when I got involved, his do for self program was phenomenal. And even until today, he was encouraging us to do for self, to own land. The man was amazing. Psychologically, he not only hit the soul and the consciousness and the psyche, the very soul of African Americans, we call ourselves Negro and colored back then, but he did so of not only later when we start calling ourselves Black, he hit the depth of the American consciousness. No matter what ethnic group you were a part of during that time, the man was phenomenal. Educationally, he actually pioneered for us more than any other single individual, taking control of what goes on in our minds, and to the point where he was the leader, of course, but his wife, Clara Muhammed, through the both of them working together, and especially through Clara Muhammed, the University of Islam was launched and made some phenomenal results. And I was a part of that in Cincinnati, Ohio, and Los Angeles, California, and later in Texas. So he made a profound impact on the psyche of the world at that time. Actually, he actually had global impact. Many people didn't get to know him as we did here in America, but he impacted people across the globe. Again, he was responsible for a Muhammad Ali and the impact that Muhammad Ali had on the world, and even Malcolm, Malcolm X, Malcolm Shabazz. So in terms of diplomacy, like again, a master at on the diplomatic level, and in terms of being able to just touch on matters and of concern that impacted the whole global economy, the whole global moral state. He challenged science, history. He was a diplomatic master, and emotionally, I mean, he loved people. He loved humanity. It came out in how he expressed that love for his people. But if you got to know Elijah Muhammad like I did, I was one of his ministers. You know, I was a young man, 20 years old, and I don't think I, before I became 21, I was already became a minister in Dayton, Ohio. I had an opportunity to meet him later. So a little man in stature, physical stature, and very humble, but powerful. You know, he challenged the same people that he was describing as being the devil. The same people that he exposed in terms of the cruelty that we received during slavery and afterwards. I can recall one time when he was threatened by racists down in Georgia. As a matter of fact, he had planned on making a visit there, and they threatened him. And warned him not to come, and he met that with a counter offer. I won't call it a threat. And he told them that if they showed up with their white sheets on their head, they wouldn't have a head to put the white sheet on. That kind of talking impressed me as a young man that was looking for answers that would the reason why we ended up as a whole ethnic group in the shape that we were in across the country, but especially in the part of the world that I was born and raised in, out in Watts, out in Southern California, in the South Central Los Angeles, a very despicable existence that the people had accepted in their life. And there was no real, as brother talked about hope a minute ago, we didn't see any hope. We didn't see any future, you know. But Elijah Muhammad ignited something in my soul, in my consciousness, that only the one that could take that baton that he put in my hands to run my part of the race with, the only one that could take it and take me another leg in the journey was his son, Imam W. Deen Mohammed. And I was fortunate to be able to get to know Imam Mohammed on a personal level, and to see him be able to take the work of his father and to have that level of regard and respect for it. And Elijah Muhammad was wise enough to make sure that he prepared his family. He had two of his sons that he had that was taught Quran, that was taught the Quranic Arabic, and Imam Muhammad took it very seriously, and he began growing even before his father passed, 1975. And he started establishing his own independent thinking. Just the fact that his father was wise enough, was a deep thinker enough to prepare him to be able to step up into that role. It was no coincidence that Imam Muhammad was able to do the work that he did. You know, Allah gave him the environment, a very unique environment that none of us had. You know, he wasn't exposed in his home environment to Christianity like most of us were, and not Christianity in any kind of Christian way, but corrupted version of it. And so by the time Imam W. Deen Mohammed, much later in his mission, challenged that idea, you know, 1975, he came right out the box and he challenged the teachings, you know, that his father had, you know, and he had to slowly, very slowly bring us up out of that. I remember his father had described through one of his Theology of Time lectures, he talked about total triple darkness. And so he inspired my young mind. I was in a collegiate situation. I didn't get a degree, but I was a math major. So I was scientifically inclined. But I didn't really become a serious student until I was challenged by Elijah Muhammad. I didn't know anything about really going into the encyclopedias and doing research. But Elijah Muhammad challenged my thinking. I didn't take off the way our beloved international instructor Bilal did and make the effort to really go into linguistics as an independent study and etymology in particular. But I was challenged by Elijah Muhammad, you know, with so-called third grade education. He was heavily impressed with and prepared by the fitra, you know, and the language that he provided for us, it was anchored in the fitra. It had just very solidly questioned the sense, what I call the common sense, the logic of what we were being told by our what he described as our slave masters during the time and their children, and he tackled it with wisdom, with insight, but he did it with passion. He used compassion as well, but he was very passionate in the way he approached life. And Imam Muhammad just picked up on that spirit, that drive. But at the same time, he had to take us out of that total triple darkness that his father had described. So with that, I remember his father also talked about the light. He said, the light is on. And I see our beloved instructor is ready.
Alhamdulillah. Can you hear me loudly and clearly?
Loudly and clearly.
Okay. All right. Let us begin with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. And that is with Allah's signature, the merciful benefactor or the merciful redeemer. We're going to continue the discussion that our dear brother here, William Safir, began in terms of going into what I hope to be a deeper understanding of the early presentation of information by Imam W. Deen Mohammed, who, as many of you know, upon taking the mantle of leadership from his father, who passed in February of 1975, Imam W. Deen Mohammed came into office being known as Supreme Minister Wallace D. Mohammed. And from that title of Supreme Minister, he changed it a few months later to Chief Minister. So he went from being supreme. I want you to follow his logic. We're talking about his logic and language today. He went from being supreme minister to being chief minister. Then he changed the title minister to the more Islamically appropriate title of imam. So he became chief imam, the first imam in his association of followers. And keep in mind now that he was then over the more than 300,000 registered followers of his father, Elijah Muhammad. 300,000, with several million people actually listening during the day of Elijah Muhammad to the message of Elijah Muhammad, which had become very strong, especially amongst the larger cities of this particular country and even outside of this country in several of the islands, such as Bermuda, in other parts of the West Indies, and even in parts of Africa, they knew about Elijah Muhammad. So he went from being chief imam to just being called imam. And that's when he began to give the title imam to others who were former ministers, on the most part, in his father's nation of Islam. So there's a progressional movement that was taking place even during the Honorable Elijah Muhammad's day, when there were significant changes that Elijah Muhammad himself brought about. Now, we'll save that for another day. But suffice it to say that when his son Wallace D. Muhammad came into office, his overall motive was to humanize the community. And what do I mean by humanize the community? The language that his father used for better than 40 years was a language that was designed to inflate the egos and to resensitize those areas of the so-called Black man's life that had become desensitized because of slavery, Jim Crow, and many of the other atrocities that were being meted out amongst people and upon people that were at that time called Negroes, colored, and Black. So Elijah Muhammad saw part of his job, his duty, his responsibility as the reawakening, as he called it, of the dead. The resurrection of the dead is what he called it. We'll be talking about that word dead in just a moment, because obviously he wasn't talking about people who were physically dead. He was talking about the idea of dead as the scriptures themselves give that term. And again, I'll show you proof for that in just a moment. So W. Deen Mohammed took us through a language evolution, not a physical revolution, but a language evolution. And it was the evolution of the terminology that he presented to not only the Nation of Islam followers, but he presented that information freely to the world through the major organ of communication at that time, which was called Muhammad Speaks Newspaper. You've heard Malcolm X talk about the Muhammad Speaks Newspaper. And the Muhammad Speaks Newspaper itself had a language evolution and became several kinds of morphed titles until it ended up being the American Muslim Journal, and then finally the Muslim Journal, which it's now known as today. It's still in existence all of these many years later. So we're talking about a conceptual progression and a conceptual evolution of language. A conceptual evolution of language. You've heard Instructor Benjamin Bilal speak on the process of creation that involves the initial movement being what's called involution. We hear all of these scientists and these Darwinists and these other theorists speak about the theory of evolution, but I haven't heard a peep out of any of them concerning the process called involution. And as Muslim readers of Al-Quran, we know that Allah says that he created everything, what's called Zawjain. Zawj just simply means mate. The proper mate for that thing. If you don't have the proper mate, you're not going to procreate. You can love dogs as much as you want. It doesn't mean that if you get with a dog sexually, that you're going to have a human dog. It doesn't happen. Unless your mate is a dog. Let's hope that's not the case. So much as our young men like calling their women bitches, we got to be careful of that one. Yeah, so no. Theoretically, conceptually,
we want to be able to procreate amongst people who consider themselves also to be truly human like ourselves. And zawj means corresponding mate, suitable mate, as Allah created that mate to be, so that we could prolong our species here on this planet. That's what zawj is referring to. And the evolution of this language is what we're dealing with right now, what we will be dealing with further into this conversation, the evolution of language. So the Nation of Islam's progress was, as I call it, under the influences of an involution, not an evolution. The Nation of Islam was not an evolution. The Nation of Islam, this is just me speaking, was an involutionary development. What does that mean? It means that during the process of involution, things are manifest into that environment that allows for the coming together of the essential properties necessary so that when that thing becomes freed from its involutionary state, and as it exits that involutionary state into an evolutionary state, it will have most of what's necessary for its survival on the evolutionary side. Now, you might not be able to picture that in your brain if you haven't been studying science, but you can picture it just by understanding what happens in the womb of a mother whose baby is in gestation. That gestation, those 8 to 9 months, are an involutionary process. That baby is in her. He has not exited her to begin his or her own personal evolution. That baby is becoming involved in matter. Matter is constantly accruing. Matter is constantly being manifest out of nowhere. Where are those eyeballs coming from? Where did that heart come from as the first major organ being developed in the womb? Where did it come from? That's what we mean by involution. Allah is the one who manifests creation first out of nothing, and then through an involutionary process, which eventually on the other end produces an evolutionary creature or creation. So again, the pregnancy itself is the involutionary side of the life form, where things are becoming involved in the creation of that particular baby to be. Once it has gotten enough of what it needs on the involutionary side, then Allah allows that baby to become born. And there is where the evolutionary side of its development begins. It is still developing to a degree involutionary, even if after it's born out of its mother, because there are qualities that need to be developed. But those qualities are dependent on quantities that develop during involution. I hope I'm not being too heavy for any of you. I don't think I am. During involution, while in the womb, Allah is developing quantities of things, fingers, first buds, then fingers, then fingernails, heart, then veins and lungs and kidneys. And all of those things are being developed involutionarily inside the mother. Those are quantities, not qualities. We can't say that at 6 months old, that baby to be is a genius or intelligent. We can't judge a quality while it's in its involutionary state. We can only look through the looking glass of the doctor at the doctor's office and say, okay, sonogram says, oh, he's got five fingers. Well, actually, it literally is four fingers and a thumb, if you go technically speaking, right? But the doctor can say that, yeah, his eyes are spaced right, you know, from each other, and his ears are on the sides of his head and not on his cheek. You know, these things happen, right? And everything is looking good on the sonogram. And I'm telling you, they got some sonograms now that are, now I don't want to call them scary, but they're just such a miraculous thing to look at. Because, I mean, they're in full color, and you can literally see the baby putting his thumb in his mouth and sucking his thumb. He's 8 months in the mother's womb. But he's going through a process of involution where matter is becoming more and more involved, not yet evolved, involved. Once the baby is born, then the baby begins to take on instinctive, emotional, and eventually mental not quantities. You can't weigh knowledge and you can't weigh morality. You can't weigh sensibility or common sense. Those are qualities that have exponential growth. You can't contain intelligence. You can't say how smart this creation is. And the creation is very smart. The creation itself has intelligence. How do we know? Because even after the baby is born, the baby's hair keeps growing. Who's doing that? The baby's nails keep growing. Who's doing that? The baby has five senses that have developed. Did the mother give the baby its five senses and the marching orders for those five senses? Absolutely not. These are creative qualities and quantities that are assumed by that developing baby. And the baby that is developed and born out of the mother begins to take on more qualities along with whatever quantities were not developed while in the womb. The human baby is one of few, maybe the only biological creature that comes here incomplete. You ever see how a horse is born? A colt? That mother horse drops that baby out and that baby's up and running in minutes. You're running around the field. You got babies that come out and they just automatically know what to do. These babies are born on the most part complete enough to live independently of whatever that environment challenges them with. See, they know how to do that. And whatever they're not doing, they learn it fairly quickly compared to human growth and development. Humans, it takes, what, a year or two before we even start learning how to walk? Most creatures, they're up and running in a half an hour, whatever it is. They're wobbly, but they're running. The fish are swimming. The whale that is born, the baby whale, is swimming alongside its mother. So those creatures are born with a fuller capacity in terms of their wholeness than a human baby who's born, as Allah says in the Quran and another place, partly formed, partly unformed. That's not just for in the womb. That's also outside of the womb. That's not just for the involutionary development. That's also for its evolutionary development. And believe it or not, it's also for its social development, that we are born partly formed and partly unformed. And that's how I describe the Nation of Islam experience in a nutshell. It was between involution and evolution. The partly formed part of it was coming into its evolutionary development with the introduction to the Quran, with the introduction to the word Allah, introduction to the word or the name Muhammad. See, the Nation of Islam, they had all of that. The introduction, that the introduction is not the thing. That's just pointing you towards what's necessary for your evolution once the involutionary part of your development ceases and desists. That's why the Nation of Islam under that aegis had to die. People, they charged W.D. Muhammad. They say, you killed your father's work. They don't understand that it was a work that was born to die, just like the existence of the infant in the womb during gestation was born to die. That if it had kept growing in the womb, it would have killed the mother and the child. And that's a fact. There were other organizations that were in their involutionary stages also. At that same time, Marcus Garvey's Universal Negro Improvement Association. I could name five, six of them that were existing at the same time. They were all in existence simultaneously. But how many of them are here now to recount their history for you? Very few. And if they're here, they're not in the same spirit and motivation that they were in back in the early 1900s, in the 20s, the 30s, the 40s, when most of these organizations appeared in the so-called African-American community. So Allah was doing something very, very specific. And I don't want this understanding to be lost on anybody, particularly people who are not familiar with the history of what has been happening in this country pre-slavery, during slavery, post-slavery, which the historians now call the Jim Crow period. we're not familiar with how Allah is shaping and has been shaping the destiny of not only a particular people in history, but Allah does this for all societies and has done this for all times. You merely have to study the nuances that are built into the social, spiritual, and even the economic development of people of the past, whether you're talking about in Cuba or South America or parts of Africa, other parts of Asia, India, so forth, Ethiopia, all of these places had this same unique kind of development when it comes to what Allah says he includes in the development when he says he created us from dust to sperm drop, say, to ovum, you know, to alaq, you know. That progression is not just physical or biological. That progression is involutionary, evolutionary, and social also. So partly formed, partly unformed mean that you're living with an ideology that is not complete. And that again was the nation of Islam. Partly formed in Islam, Islamic terminology, assalamu alaikum, everywhere you go, but partly unformed. Because if you were to ask who the messenger of Islam is, they tell you Elijah Muhammad. See, that's partly unformed. If you were to ask, oh, I see you say Allah is God. Who is Allah, brother? Who is Allah for you? They would say Mr. or Master W.D. Farad is God. Is Master Farad Muhammad is Allah for us. See, that's partly unformed. Partly formed, we recognize the name Allah. Partly unformed, we say he's W.D. Farad. Partly formed, we recognize the name Allah. We say he's W.D. Farad. We recognize the name Muhammad. We say it's not Prophet Muhammad. We respect that. There was a prophet named Muhammad 1,400 years ago. But the Muhammad of the Quran, they said, was Elijah Muhammad. So I'm saying all of this to set the table for the discussion that we're going to have related to the word-for-word pronouncements given by Imam W.D. Muhammad upon first accepting the leadership role over his father's nation of Islam, and the tremendous level of mental and moral and spiritual maneuvering that he had to do with the language, not with a pistol, saying you better do this or else. No, he wasn't a dictator like over in other parts of the world. You better do this or die. No, that's not what he did. He picked up the sword called the S word, the sacred word of the Quran, which his father did not do. His father taught mostly out of the Bible, because that's where most Black Americans, that's where their heads were. It was in Christianity in the Bible. So Elijah Muhammad had to first dismantle the Bible. That's what I mean by involutionary. Involutionary means that as you continue to grow, you depend less and less on your initial development. If we were to depend on our initial development as human beings growing in the womb, we'd all come out here looking like tadpoles. Do you know that's a part of our evolutionary embryonic development, that we look exactly like tadpoles? Make sure your children and your children's children study what I'm saying and verify it. Go to the books, go to the internet and verify what I'm saying. Just ask Sheikh Google, as I like to call him, online. He believes he knows all. Say, is there any period where the embryo looks like a tadpole? A little fish. And they show you the pictures of inside the mother's womb where you take a tadpole and take the embryo, and it looks exactly the same. You see? So human life, sociologically speaking, is going through the same development. Even your emotional life is going through these same stages from dust all of the way up to what Allah calls thumma. Thereafter, another creation. Allah doesn't even tell you what that creation is. For us, that another creation was a creation brought about mostly by the language and logic of Wallace Deen Mohammed, also known as Wadith Deen Mohammed. So there's much more to say on that. And we're actually going to, in semester 22, which begins July. Wow. July 1 is the net already. Wow. Semester 22. That's a lot of time we've been on this. But I'm going to have a separate webinar dealing strictly with the tafsir of Imam W.D. Muhammad from 1975 up to 2008. I will pick and choose different lectures. You will hear from him himself through the lectures or through me reading quotes from his lectures. Today's table is being set just to introduce you to what will be taking place in semester 22, because I will not be doing any more tafsir of W.D. Muhammad for this university online learning course group of subjects. We have a much wider audience now. We have people participating from across the waters and from places here in the United States who never heard of nunetics and that kind of thing. So this is going to be dedicated specifically to nunetics and what needs to be known for understanding the Quran better and the English language better and the Hebrew language. We're going to go into the Hebrew language, some Greek. So we're going to be expanding also on this side of the fence, but we're going to save W.D. Muhammad for the other side of the fence, that when you want to visit that neighbor, you just knock on his door, ask permission to enter. And that's going to be strictly information dealing with the language and logic of Imam W.D. Muhammad. And I'm doing that in an effort to make sure that we do not create another sect. Listen to me carefully now. I will not be responsible in the judgment for having set up another sect. Now, you might say, what is a sect? S-E-C-T. That's just a shortened word for section. Allah says, do not divide yourselves into sects. Because if we do, Allah says that Satan does that to groups of people. He divides them into sects so that they might lose their power. So your power is in unity. You can believe different levels of whatever it is that you say you believe in. Everybody's not going to be the same. That's a part of the beauty of humanity, that we're going to accept certain, but it doesn't mean that we have to use those differences in order to create artificial barriers between each other. And now I'm talking about the different religions. We don't have to be enemies of people because they say they believe something different than what we believe. We don't have to declare jihad, you know, jihad on people who say that they love Jesus. No, Allah knows how to deal with all of that. Some Muslims' fervor for Muhammad is even greater than Christians' fervor for Jesus. Some Muslims have created a Jesus Christ from Muhammad the prophet. They see him as being more extraordinary human than the average human being, when Allah tells you clearly in the Quran that he himself says in the Quran, "Ana basharun mithlukum," I'm immortal like all the rest of you. That's in the Quran. So that what happened with Jesus in history, Isa, as he's called in the Quran, would not happen with Muhammad, because Allah locked that key into the Quran itself, not into somebody's commentary or hadith. He locked that key so that you would always be able to access it and open that door and say, well, is Muhammad more than a human? Wait a minute. Muhammad is but a messenger. That's in the Quran. He's a messenger. He's immortal. Another key. Had you been angels walking around on earth, Allah says, I would have sent you an angel as a messenger. That's another key. So these people are not immortals, like you find in those superhero movies and comic books. That's not what these people are. These people are inspired humans. That's what we have to understand. So let's get a little bit into the language. Again, this is the introduction to the language and logic of W.D. Muhammad, which will be continued in July on a separate portal. It won't be even on YouTube when that happens. So if those of you who are interested, I'll know if you're truly interested. Because when I make the announcement on YouTube for you to send your names and whatever it is, and that course is going to be totally free of charge, and I'm not charging a dime for that. The University Online Learning Course is an actual course where you pay a fee per semester. But the W.D. Muhammad thing, that's for whoever wants to be there. If it's 10 people, alhamdulillah. If it's 10,000 people, alhamdulillah. But I'll tell you this, if it's only 10 people, those other 9,990 people are going to be missing something tremendous in terms of help for their intellect and for their soul. I can tell you that. And you'll understand that better after today's presentation, inshallah. All right. So let me find my information. I'm going to be reading this from my screen. However, I'm not going to post these words on the screen. So you'll have to continue looking at me, I guess, as I read this. And I'm only doing that because of the way it's transcribed as a PDF. It would be confusing to you because I have to continue going up and down the script to find the next line. You know how PDFs can be. So we begin here again. The verbatim words of Imam W.D. Muhammad. If I'm going to introduce my own thoughts, I'll let you know that, and I'll let you know when I continue with his. So, quote, the Bible tells us of two forces or two people or two companies. One is described as agents of Almighty God or saints of Almighty God or the friends of Almighty God who go about in the earth, searching the earth, to find those that they can present to God as being worthy. Then we have the other company, the enemies, the wicked, the Satan and his disciples, called the Shaitan in the Quran, and his devils, who also go about in the earth. You find this in Job, I believe. They go also about in the earth, but they are seeking those that they can bring before God to prove them unworthy. Those that want to show a worthy person to Almighty God are those who have God and his great truth and his great purpose for them. But those who want to show God's people or the people of the earth as being unworthy are those who resent God's great plan. They are enemies of God. They are the ones who began with the great Satan, who got proud and boastful when God said to the angels, I am going to make a man of black mud or earth fashioned into shape. And he said, meaning God said, when I have duly proportioned him and when I have breathed into him of my spirit, meaning my truth, then fall down and make prostration or obeisance to him. And the proud Satan, the proud devil, he became puffed up with pride and could not find it in himself to bow down to something that would be made from lowly material. Follow this man's logic. He could not find it in himself to bow down and submit to that which had not a superior origin, as the devil thought that he himself had. He was not a devil before he rebelled. He was the chief among the angels. But when he rebelled, he became fit to be called Satan, which means the enemy, and that is the enemy of God and man. He said, meaning Iblis at this point, I am better than he. You made me of fire. Fire in the scripture means knowledge. The knowledge that is gotten from the study or in the study of the physical world. Isn't that beautiful? Fire is symbolic of knowledge, knowledge that is accrued through the study of the physical world. No revelation brings this knowledge that the Satan or the enemy boasted in. That knowledge comes by the efforts of the mind and its interaction with the physical creation. Just like the child playing with objects in the house, he learns something of those objects and comes into a knowledge of the home environment. Man grows up to manhood and his knowledge increases and he becomes a scientist and he studies the earth and the environment, the water, the air, the sun, the heavens, and what is beneath the surface of the earth. And he comes up with a great accumulation of knowledge. This knowledge is knowledge out of the physical creation. The physical sun is a part of the whole or the total physical creation. And that physical sun is a ball of fire. And that ball of fire enables us to see the physical eye. The other, pardon me, enables us to see with the physical eye the other physical objects in our environment. So the sun enables us to see objects that we can't see when there is darkness. The knowledge that we get out of the study or from the study of the physical world serves as light for the mind to show us that of the physical creation that the physical light cannot show us. So knowledge is a sun, S-U-N, a mental sun, a sun for the mind of the people. Knowledge enables us to walk about in dark areas because we have knowledge of the dark areas. A man can walk about in his house without the lights being turned on in the house because he has another light. That is the light of knowledge, the knowledge of his home. He knows the rooms, he knows the stairways, so the lights can go off. The power failure can come, and he still can make his way about in his home. That is because he has another light, the light of knowledge. This is the light that the enemy of God boasted in. This is what made him so proud. It made him think that he is superior to the man that God said he would make and fashion and breathe into him the word of his own knowledge. You see, Satan felt superior to him because he had not seen the knowledge of Almighty God manifested in man or in the man that God would make. That is in the messengers, in the prophets, the messengers, and the righteous servants of Almighty God. The enemy had not seen God make a righteous man and give him from his knowledge. So he thought that something made from the ignorant people, something made from those who just are nothing but a mass of flesh like earth fashioned into shape, but without the learned mind. Something like that, an uneducated person, how is he worthy? So worthy that I have to bow down to him, God. But God, in his answer, said, I know what you know not. God knew his plan. He knew what the man was capable of doing. He knew that his man would not have to come through the schools of the scientists. Oh, I hope y'all are listening carefully. He knew that his man, meaning God's man, would not have to come through the schools of the scientists. He knew that his man would not have to come through the studies of the world, that he, being the all-knowing who makes possible the science we call physical science, human science, or world knowledge, that he could make a man from nothing and give him in a short time knowledge from himself, and that knowledge would enable that man to stand above the scientists of the world. Alhamdulillah.
Alhamdulillah.
Yeah. How beautiful it is.
Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah.
Station break. Oh, man, give me a minute. Whew, boy. Okay, let's continue. He knew that, as I'm reading this, I want you to think about today's time. Forget 1975. This is timeless, what I'm telling you right here. Listen carefully. He knew. Meaning Allah knew that, and forgive me, for the term God is one that we still use as Muslims because we know we're talking to a much wider audience than just Muslims. We're talking to people who speak English from Christianity, from other backgrounds, and they understand God to be the supreme being. They're not having any issues like that on the most part. Even those who say, you know, somebody else is the son of God or, you know, whatever. They understand that they're still a supreme creator because that knowledge is in their book also. They just need some clarifications, that's all. So that's what we mean here, or I should say what he means here when he says God. We were coming out of a period of our involutionary development where the term God had been impressed upon our brains through Christianity and through just the life of religion as we understood it back in the day. So he knew that his knowledge in that man would be greater light. And when the light comes, it would make the light of the world, that is the light of physically arrived at knowledge. Speaking to those sciences again. It would make the light of the physically arrived at knowledge. It would make that light, the light of the scientist, the light of the world, it would make that light appear as darkness. Think about the crazy kinds of things they're introducing today as science. That there's no such thing as two genders. As darkness. That this race is greater than that race. The geneticists and these other people who postulate these crazy theories. You understand? That's the darkness of this world science. Freudian psychology is this world science. Darwinian evolutionary theory is this world science. It's darkness. So it would make the light appear as darkness. And the book says, meaning the Bible, the light of this world is darkness with God. So God says, when I have fashioned him, and have duly proportioned him. So way to who, when I have duly proportioned him, evenly balanced him is what this is saying. What does this mean? The man comes up on the earth as a child, and when he is first delivered out of the womb of his mother, he comes into the world that may be bright with daylight, but is totally dark to the baby because the baby simply knows nothing of this new world. Now, full of light, lights, camera, action, the baby comes down to shoot out of the mother and the doctor is there and the lights from the emergency room or the delivery room, whatever the room is called. Those lights are shining bright and you might even have some people flashing bulbs, taking pictures of the baby being born, all kinds of stuff that people do. But in the baby's mind, it's totally dark because the baby knows absolutely nada about this life that he just slipped into. He's actually, as the song War, that group, they said, slipping into darkness. So that's what he's doing when he comes out the chute. And that baby, because of its mother, clings to its mother. It feels an identity with its mother. It knows it came from a warm environment and it clings or it pulls to or it draws to the warmth of its mother. This baby, listen to this point he's making. Make a note of this. This baby is a child of want. Want is just another word for desire. I've been giving you this as nunetics and lessons for years now. We're born into a world of desire. Things that we need, so we want those things that we need. My commentary, going back to Imam Muhammad's words. This baby is a child of want. It has not come into the knowledge of the world and developed into the stages that were intended by the Almighty God for it. It is just fresh and new into the world, out of one womb of darkness into another womb of darkness. So it's coming out of the womb of darkness from its mother's interior. That's dark enough. But when it comes here and it has no knowledge of what's out here, that's another womb. The environmental womb that it knows nothing about is a second womb of darkness. So out of one womb of darkness into another womb of darkness. But this baby begins to grow as a creature begging. This is such a beautiful part when I read this. It begins to grow as a creature begging, a creature in a metaphorical way, a creature praying even from the womb. So you thought praying was salat. This baby is born making dua, trying to communicate with another entity. Help me. I'm asking. I have wants and desires, and I need assistance. I was good to go an hour ago when I was in my mother turning upside down and doing flips and all of that. That amusement park. I know it's not an amusement park. Yeah, I knew I'm exaggerating there. But the baby was good to go for 8-9 months, and then all of a sudden, flip, and out the chute. So beautiful. But this baby begins to grow as a creature begging, a creature in a metaphorical way, a creature praying even from the womb, praying for food and protection. Isn't that first level of chakra? This is me talking now. You know, that root, red root chakra, Yeah, that's where every human being and what every human being is born into. The red, literally born out of the red, the blood that has to be shed when every infant comes out of its mother's belly. And what does that red chakra represent? Safety, the need for security, safety, peace. Now, so God, in his great wisdom in the script book, he tells man when he grows to be a big man on the earth and thinking that he is the boss of everything, God says in his great scripture, reflect, go back and think on how you came into being. That's in the Quran. You didn't come into being boasting. You didn't come into being ruling over anything. You didn't come into being dictating to the world. I, the greatest sheikh, priest, rabbi, imam, mufti says, off with their heads. You didn't come into the world like that, declaring jihad. Yeah, the doctor, yeah. Who pulling me out of this? Brought me into this oppression. We must declare jihad. No, infant. That's me talking now, not Imam Muhammad. No, that's not what a newborn does. Continuing the quote from Imam Muhammad. You didn't come into being dictating to the world. And I hope the dictators of the world will get hold of this video. And I'm talking about not only the dictators overseas, within this country, but I'm talking even about the dictators who are dictating to their own families about what the wife better do or else, or what the children better do, or now the children are dictating to the parents what they better do or else. You came in hungry, and my mercy, meaning Allah's mercy, informing your mother provided you with food and with protection and with comfort, and she didn't have to run out to the local supermarket to get your food. Allah packed that food in her breasts so that you would have a ready-made food source when you arrived. She didn't have to put in an order and ask whoever those food service cars and stuff call certain services. Okay, he's about to come. Can you at least be on your way? No, Allah put that food right here. It's an amazing creation, this human creation. Biology, the life of the world itself is so miraculous. It's wonderful. Thank you. Alhamdulillah. We thank Allah. Continuing. And then he raised them out of that, meaning that desire level, that want level, and brought him into another form. He formed the man from a creature of a want into a creature of emotion. The first creature, and I say creature, when I say creature, he said, I mean of the creation. So sometimes we hear the word creature and we start thinking beast and that kind of thing. No, anything that's been created is a creature. And there's a hint here, a nunetic hint, if you would not mind me adding my two cents. There's a nunetic hint here in the word creature. And it's in the first part of the word, the first syllable, create. Create, create. You see the CR, which is really the KR sound. So the KRA in creature is basically the same as the QRA sound in the verb qara'a. And qara'a gives us the word ikra. And they say that ikra means to read. And instructor Benjamin Millal has said differently, it can mean read down the line, but not as an initial meaning. The initial meaning for qara'a means that he gathered or he collected something, because it's an agricultural term referring to the work of the agriculturalist once the harvest becomes due. And you have to go out and collect the corn, collect the wheat, collect the whatever other foods you are out there attempting to grow. And if you don't get it, it's like the baby. If you don't get that baby out when it's due, either the baby gonna die or the mother's gonna die or both are gonna die. Because that's a kind of a baby harvest. when the baby is due after 9 months going into 10 months. The baby is due. That baby's got to come out. And the same thing with the wheat. When it's due, if you don't pluck it and pick it and take it to the farm or take it to the dinner table, it's going to become rotten, spoiled, and it will die in the field. It will die. So the CR in creature is the QR in Qara'ah, which again doesn't mean he read anything. It means he collected something. I'm sure Mahir, when we open up for questions and answers, will have something very wonderful to say about that. And he's another one come semester 22. He's going to have his own seed cast program. I know y'all have been itching, chomping at the bit to hear from Bahir. But you're going to be able to hear from him where he's able to hold his own. I'll join him on a few occasions, you know, back and forth type thing. But he's got so much valuable information. This man has obviously been blessed by Allah with knowledge that many of us have not yet come into. Not that you can't. Anybody can come into anything that I've taught as long as you study what I teach you. It's really that easy, that simple. And you can do the same thing with Mahir. You can't duplicate what he's saying or what I'm saying because you don't have our same experiences with knowledge. That's the only way you can't duplicate us, but you can go past us in areas where you have the greater experience. So utilize the experience that you have. Don't do it trying to be me or trying to be Mahir, or trying to be somebody else, or trying to be a Dr. Omar, Ramahir. You can't be any of us, but you can go past any of us. Let's continue. So creature and Qara'ah are related in my mind. And what you're actually reading, if you're reading anything, is that you're reading the behaviors of creation. You're reading the behaviors of the creature, otherwise known as its fitrah. The first human creature was a creature of want. But wanting and having the want answered brought appreciation in that creature. Oh, man, this is so beautiful. The first creature, no matter what the creature is, when it's first delivered, it is a creature of want, desire. Yeah. There's even wisdom in the English word desire. Sire, you know what that means. To have multiple babies. And that was the name for the king, right? Yes, sire. Desire means to take that ability away. You know, that baby comes here, he can't sire anything. All he can do is want. That's it. Yeah, so we're all born as creatures of desire. It's wonderful. The word is also connected to the word star. And it represents a level of the star that is experienced when the star falls. So desire represents the falling star. You already know that D and T are interchangeable. So the D, S, R in desire is also the STR in star. That's what desire represents, the falling of the star. Whatever star means, whatever star represents, desire is that level where it has to be put out of heaven. In other words, you know how people say babies come here straight from heaven? Yeah, they're falling stars. Metaphorically speaking, falling stars. Let's continue. So, creature of want is how we come here. But wanting and having the want answered brought about appreciation in that creation and brought about love in that creature for that mother who is answering that hunger. My words. Now, I want you to think about how we begin reading the Quran with the essential words after saying Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. We're inviting Allah into our conversation for quality assurance every time we do that. We're asking Allah to sign off on whatever it is we're about to say, do, feel, think, And then Allah says, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, that the praise belongs to Allah. And He is the one who involves and evolves creation. And He does that for Al-Alameen, for all dimensions, for all systems of knowledge that you'll ever come into. Allah is constantly after involving them and giving them their first development. He takes them out of that womb and delivers them into a bigger womb called evolution. And Allah is doing that for everything operating in creation, especially if that creation has what's called sentience, meaning the ability to think and make choices. And that doesn't have to be human or animal. Plants make choices. You don't believe it? Put your plant next to your stereo speakers and play loud rock and roll and hip hop. And come back a week later, you're going to see the leaves on that plant move away from the speakers. If it could, it would pick itself up and get the heck out of that room, because it's vibration is being disturbed by this loud, rambunctious level of frequency. So even plants are making decisions, but even the amoeba that we don't consider to be a life form as a human life form is known. Amoeba are making, they're microscopic, I'm talking about, they are making decisions on their level of life without a brain attached. Allah has clocked a particular sentience into that creature that lets it know what its marching orders are, just instinctively. See, this is Rabbil Alameen. Continuing. So when we say Alhamdulillah, this is my point, we're doing it as a reaction to a desire that Allah has fulfilled for us. Alhamdulillah, that means prior to that, we were asking Allah for something and Allah fulfilled it and we are thankful. See, all praise belongs to Allah. All thanksgiving belongs to Allah. All appreciation is due to Allah. Continuing. So the mother is answering that hunger, answering that want that made that creature, formed that creature as a creature of emotion. So remember now, it's first a creature of desire. Now it's moved up to become a creature of emotions. The creature smiles and shows pleasure when its needs are answered. And the creature frowns or cries and shows pain and discomfort when the needs are not answered. And this brings about an emotional human being. You people in the fields of personal and social psychology, you should be taking notes like it's going out of style right now. We're developing our own fitra-based psychology based on this kind of language and logic, and other great minds that have contributed to fitra or nature-based psychology that does not, I would say, go against the natural framework that the creator has created. It doesn't suggest things in its explanations of psychology that go against how your mind works naturally, how your emotions work naturally, how even your instinctive drives work naturally. We first go to the natural form and function of those parts of the human life. We go to the natural form and function, and then we let how we treat those areas become the outgrowth of that information. We don't superimpose some artificial behavior on what Allah has created as natural behavior. That's what the world of psychology and pharmaceutical industry, that's what they're trying to do right now. Impose a foreign solution to something that can be handled naturally. So your 10-year-old, suddenly he feels like a girl. And they say, we got a drug for that now. We have surgery for that now. See, that's what I mean by superimposing an artificial remedy on something that could have been handled naturally if you only had the skill and the insight into how Allah's scripture, particularly Al-Quran, treats these subjects. Oh boy, we're going to have a good next 2-3 years together if you stick with this. Continuing. And the creature frowns or cries and shows pain and discomfort when the needs are not answered. And this brings about an emotional human being, one that responds to its emotional needs. So God then, in the womb of emotion, nourishes this creature. He hammers on this creature. He fires. He blows the billows of flames on this creature. And he burns him. Listen carefully. And he then cools him so much that he almost freezes him. Then he handles him so delicately, sometimes as though he is back in the womb with no pain. This is the life of our childhood. Everybody's childhood goes through these extremes, but it is these extremes that are responsible for shaping, forming, and fashioning our emotional nature. Remember, Allah says, when I have balanced him and then breathed into him of my ruh, of my spirit. See, this is the balancing part. So'ituhu, giving him his uswa, his balance, his sense of, his sense of balance. That happens in the psyche. Continuing. Then he handles him so delicately, sometimes as though he is back in the womb with no pain, with no cares whatsoever. He carries him from one extreme to the other in the womb of emotion to see if he is worthy of recognizing that he is in the hand of a mighty God. And out of the womb of emotion, if he is worthy, he grows to love knowledge because his emotions arouses in him a curiosity. So that's the next level. You went from want or desire to emotion to curiosity. And it's the curiosity that's going to allow him or her into the door that we call knowledge, which is feeding then the intellect. How come I am dashed from one extreme to another? How come I am heated to the extreme and then cooled to an extreme? How come I am comforted until I am just filled with joy? Then I am starved until I feel emptiness and almost death. This is humanity he's speaking about, not just an individual child or anything. That would be child abuse. But humanity goes through these stages and these extremes. He begins to ask questions of the activities that are going on in the emotional womb. And then asking these questions makes him grow into knowledge. And then he becomes a creature of knowledge. When he becomes a man of knowledge, and by man we mean male or female, then he stops responding so much to emotions. You young people, listen to this carefully. When he becomes a man of knowledge, then he stops responding so much to emotions. He trusts the solid ground of knowledge. And he questions emotion to see if it is befitting of me to give in to this emotion. So before you let that emotion just take you over, oh, I'm angry. You said such and such. You called me without my name. And I'm, you know, in Walmart, you know, and female, they, you know, whatever, taking stuff off, taking earrings out their ear. Yeah, they will fight now, right? Before you go through all of that, you have to first question the emotion to see if it is worthy of me giving in to this emotion. What's going to be the outcome of this? I got my two little babies here in the supermarket with me, but I want to fight this person. I don't know. This person got a knife, got a gun. I don't know. The person can fight. Person's a wrestler. I don't know what this person is, but I'm taking a chance at them beating me to death halfway at least, or doing something that's going to leave my children injured or maybe in the hands of the government because they saw me as being neglectful. So you have to question emotion. Emotion doesn't have any eyes. Emotion doesn't have intelligence like we know intelligence. It's the intellect that has to make those decisions, not the emotions. The emotions are just the gas for the vehicle. They're not the motor. The motor is here. The gas is all that stuff happening here. You know how they say, oh man, don't let them gas you up. That's what they're talking about. Don't let them get you overly excited, emotionally speaking. Continuing. So you want to know, is this the proper time? Is this the proper thing to laugh in or to laugh with or to laugh about? Sometimes things ain't funny for the people that are around you listening. You laugh at somebody who something bad happened in the public or whatever, or some mishap or something, you standing there, and it ain't the right time for that. You laughing because somebody got injured? They got these videos all day long on YouTube about bad things that happen, mishaps that happen to people that you know that person was hurt, but the people around them taking the video, they laugh and they falling out. Is that appropriate? Oh boy. So is this the proper time to laugh? Is this the proper time to shed tears? You see? This is the way men and women of knowledge respond to things. You know, if you go to a baby and you tell the baby that you have to make a decision or I have to place a decision on you, child, you can't eat chocolate candy anymore. The first reaction that you get is an emotional reaction, and it is hard to get from that baby a reaction to knowledge. Simply because that baby is growing out of emotion. He is a form of emotion growing into the form of knowledge. Sidebar. See, when you understand what Imam Muhammad is actually addressing here, you should also understand that when you see these behaviors, it better equips you to know how to deal with these behaviors, how to assess. Stand back and question and say, that's interesting. Don't just respond emotionally. Say, that's interesting. Then start letting the Rolodex of your brain go to work and say, where does this person fit in this scale of instinctive behavior, emotional behavior, moral and rational behavior? And always seek to operate from the top of that list. But you should be able to identify it right away when you see it in other people or when you see it in yourself. You should be able to put the brakes on. Whoa, no, I'm not going down that path. I can't see that. That's darkness. I can't navigate in the dark. I must stay in the light. And only knowledge can do that for me. So I'm going to respond to what I know is correct, to what Allah is pleased with. Continuing. So you tell that child, that baby, he said, that you can't eat chocolate candy anymore. You grab the chocolate bar from the child's mouth. You know what's going to happen. There's going to be an emotional reaction, and it's going to be hard to get that baby a reaction to knowledge. You can't teach that child intellectually why it shouldn't have chocolate. It's going to mess up your teeth, and it's going to mess up your blood, and you're going to get diabetes. That little baby don't know diabetes. That baby knows chocolate bar. Chocolate milk. You understand? Oh, man. All right. Now, so you will reason with that child. Pardon me. Yeah, simply because that baby is growing out of emotion. He is a form of emotion growing into a form or into the form of knowledge, right? So you will reason with that child. You will take the time and the patience to make the child see that this is the right thing to do. But you have to have a developing intellect to appeal to. That's me speaking. You have to recognize growth in your children that says, okay, I can introduce this idea now on the level of reason by asking them to compare this with that. That's all reason is. That's all the intellect is. Internal electing. That's what intellect means. Internal choosing or choice making. To make a choice, you have to have at least two things, right? So you have to be able to show that child, this is going to do either this to you or that to you. And I tell you what, if I'm going to take this from you, I want you to replace it, as the Quran advises, with something better, or at least equal. But it's going to be better for you or equal for you in terms of tasting good. But the nutrition in it is going to be superior to that chocolate that you've been sucking on and biting into. Then the child will understand, oh, you mean to tell me I can have this and it's good for me, mommy? And it even tastes better than that you took from me, mommy? Yeah, okay, well, then your child starts making more appropriate decisions. We have a granddaughter who, from birth, she never ate any candy. My children right now, they don't know eating a whole bunch of candy and all that. They know fruits and other things that they like, that adults would say, ew, I can't eat that. And the children love it because Allah created it. But when they turn you against your own fitrah, that's when you begin to have those problems. Let's continue. So you will take the time and the patience to make the child see that this is the right thing to do. I know it hurts, baby. So you try to make him see the reason, the knowledge in this. That is harmful. That is bad for him. And if you are successful, the child will accept it. But you had to first battle with the child's emotional nature, right? Now, if you go to a child who has become knowledgeable, a child who has shown himself or herself to be capable of reasoning with things, you don't have to pat him for so long. You don't have to have so much patience with him. You can go right to him and say, look, this chocolate candy is harmful to you. We think that you are eating too much of it, so you better give it some thought and reduce your intake of chocolate or cut out the intake of chocolate altogether. Thus, you can go right to the point. You don't have to come from an emotional side to get cooperation from an emotional form, you see. This is what Imam Muhammad did. I got to put this in there. When he came, he immediately started power packing our intellects with new information. His first lecture to us on that Savior's Day, February 1975, was about not being victims of the winds of emotion. You'll hear him talking about it in a minute. See, when you can direct people's attention to this thing called wayward emotion, it's the way, you know, you're supposed to have emotion. That's natural in you. But when emotions start becoming dictated to from extraneous forces that have nothing to do with your interests, that's when you come into trouble. When men come into knowledge, now they have to be reached with knowledge. Men and women of knowledge, they just don't react, respond immediately to emotions. The wind or gust of emotion just won't bring a quick response from men and women of knowledge. They want to look at it because it is not yet true light. And we hesitate before storms of darkness. You see a storm of darkness outside your window and you need to travel in that darkness. You don't just jump out there. You try to wait. Well, let me see if this storm dissipates a little bit. Let me see if all of this rain lightens up before I go and do what I need to do. So it's the same thing with human behavior. When there's darkness, emotional darkness, uncharted waters, you don't just step out there like you're Superwoman, Superman. I'll deal with it when it happens. No. You back up and you wait for the light to appear. All right, now. Continuing, the man of knowledge and the woman of knowledge, when you come to them with knowledge, right away you get a reaction. Right away you get a response. They don't hesitate. When you first find men and women of knowledge hesitating before a call or before an approach, it is because the approach is filled with the darkness of emotionalism. Join this effort, man. It's only $79 a month, man. No, man, don't worry, man. I got you on this, man. You don't have to read it for yourself. No, I don't need to make a presentation. I'm your boy. I'm your homie, man. I'm in this, man. You need to get right up in this with me, but under me. Now, if you decide to do it, you did it because that was your homie. That's an emotional decision. Any decision we make, we're supposed to give it the once over. Say, I can't answer you right now. Let me chew on it, as I like to say. Let me chew. That's what the intellect does. It's teeth. It likes to chew on things and break it down. Let me wait and present it to my wife when she gets home to see if she agrees with this or if she maybe says, this is great. Who brought you this? Yeah, go ahead and sign up. Well, no, don't do that, man. I know another sister who got boinked to a crisp messing around with that organization. So people did that and joining the Nation of Islam. And went home to their family. They said, I'm going to be a black Muslim. Their family said, I know another brother who became a black Muslim, and he ain't here to tell you about it. Something real bad happened. Well, that was him. That ain't me. You know. So you got to investigate. Say, well, wait a minute. Well, what happened? People did what? People got hurt? People got killed? What happened with Malcolm? What happened? What's going on? What's Farrakhan doing and talking? You got to question stuff. W.D. Muhammad, who is he? What qualified him to be the leader? You got to question stuff. That's what the intellect does and does best. You can't go out making major decisions based on minor emotions. I hope this is making sense. Now let's continue. So when you first find men and women of knowledge hesitating before a call or before an approach, it is because the approach is filled with the darkness of emotionalism, and they hesitate because knowledge won't permit us to walk in darkness without a light. All praise is due to Allah. In the physical world that has not known the reality of God, the men and women of knowledge are the superiors in the world. Think about 2023 now as I continue to read. In the physical world that has not known, or I would even say acknowledged, the reality of a supreme author and source creator. The men and women of knowledge are the superiors in the world. They are the gods of that world. Listen to his language. The men and women of knowledge are the gods of the physical world and its reality. So in the book, meaning the Bible, they are called the angels of God. And not only in the Bible, in the Quran also, they're called malaik. You think there's some cherubim, wings out the back, and twos and threes and fours type creatures, because you don't understand the language, but you will. So in the book, they are called the angels of God. Now there are many angels of God. God has angels serving him in the heavens. Angels that are agents, forces, working behind and in those things that we see operating in the heavens, but we can't see in those things operating. The forces that are responsible for their operation. We're talking some real fitra here now. You can see those things operating, but you can't see into those things to observe the forces behind the operation. Isn't that the fitra? Form and function. You can see the form of the clouds, but you don't know how that thing functions until you get greater scientific insight into that phenomenon. Same thing with the rain. You see it falling. You don't know what's in the raindrop. You haven't examined it yet on the scientific level. That's what the people of this world do, and they become gods, small g, in the world or the realm of physical reality. That's the fire that the Quran is discussing in relation to Iblis saying, you created me min nar, from fire. Worldly knowledge, knowledge that is accrued through my investigation of created matter. Continuing. So there are also the angels that work in the skies or in the higher regions of the physical creation. Once man with his knowledge find those angels and discover them in the light of his knowledge, they are dropped from angels and they are given new names. But until man discovers them in the light of his knowledge, he calls them angels. Back in history, there was a time when they thought lightning and thunder were gods before they looked deeper into them scientifically. Said, oh, that's how that happens. But before then, that was Thor, the god of thunder. And the other one, the god of the lightning bolt. And the other one, the god of the sea, Aquaman. And they thought all of these things were happening in the creation because their knowledge had not been sufficiently developed. So until man discovers them in the light of his knowledge, meaning his science, he calls these forces angels, meaning that they work for God, but they work outside of his sight, meaning the man's sight, the human's sight. I can't see it, so it's an angel. But once my vision is expanded, my knowledge is expanded to capture the forms and the reality of those angels that operate in the higher skies, then I can't call them angels anymore. The man of knowledge then becomes their superior. That's how Iblis, the creature of fire, became the leader of the angels. So we find in one book that God says that he made man a little below the angels. That's in the Bible. And in another book, that would be the Quran, we find that God says he made man a little above the angels. So these angels that operate in the physical creation as forces behind or in physical creation, they are nothing but agents. They are nothing but hidden forms of the physical creation. They are powers and forces that were called in ancient times angels and gods. But when we discover them in reality, we don't call them angels and gods anymore. So Genesis refers to the angels and gods, and it uses the term angel and God almost interchangeably. But once we come into the knowledge of just what these realities are, then we leave the old language of Genesis and come into the modern language of a later revelation, you see? Now, in the man's environment, or in the man's realm, the human realm, the realm of man, that world, the world of human beings, the angels are the powerful men and women of knowledge. Listen carefully. The chief Satan, the enemy there, he is the head of the human world of knowledge. He is the wisest of them all. He is the chief, right? Yes, he is the chief. And the book says that Satan was the chief. And the Bible says that Satan was the chief. Now, before God manifests his power to give new knowledge, to give knowledge from himself to creation, to man, the Satan knew no other knowledge but the knowledge that had come to him from the study of the world, those physical sciences. That's the only knowledge that Satan knew. Before Allah said, I'm going to create a man and I'm going to give him knowledge from myself. See, that's a different level right there, right? Continuing. So he knew no other knowledge. So he was the chief among the angels and he was not above them. He was not Satan, but the moment the God manifest his doings and the Satan saw a knowledge coming into being brighter than his knowledge, then he began to get jealous. He began to envy. He didn't want to share the throne. He didn't want to accept that he should step down and give first place in the house of Almighty God to the man that God makes with his own hands, metaphorically speaking. He said, God, you didn't bring me up from the ignorant of the world. You didn't bring me up from stupid society. You didn't bring me up from the illiterate. You didn't bring me up from the uncultured, from those who have no human refinement. You brought me up from fire. The scientist is born of knowledge. He is not born of what we call mud fashioned into shape. He is born of knowledge, and knowledge is like fire. Fire can disintegrate things, break things and separate the parts. Take it out of form and break up its parts and scatter it back to its original places. The fire breaks the thing up and it will throw the water, the liquid, back with the liquid. It will throw the gases back with the gases. It will throw the liquid back with the liquid, the gases back with the gases, and the solid back with the solids, right? This is what fire will do. So fire has in it the nature and the power to break up the nature of things that have been formed and throw them back where they belong to show us where their form came from, you see? So it is the great power of the scientists of the world. They have the knowledge to break up the forms that God has formed and show us where these forms came from where the pieces came together to unite and make the form that which we see. So they are proud of this great knowledge. They're busting up the human being like that right now as we speak. Busting up the male, busting up the female. They're playing Play-Doh with the entire world, taking the nose off of this one and putting it on that one, and taking the ear off of this one and putting it on the neck of the other one, and taking the sex organ off of one and putting it on the other gender. They're treating the whole world like a Play-Doh set. Mr. Potato Head type set. You know, they can just take an ear off and put it on the elbow. These people have lost their minds in this weird science that they've been practicing. Let's continue. But this fire now, think of the fire. The fire is also something that is dangerous. It is dangerous because it does not permit to be given to a definite shape. Is that right? It is not like earth. It is not even like liquid. Liquid, if you pour it into a container, it will stay in the shape of the container. It will stay in the shape of the container that you put it in. And the earth If you put it in a shape, it will stay in that shape until you take it out of its shape. But once you let fire loose, fire has to be controlled. Is that right? All right. So you see here that the Satan here, the enemy, he is proud because he says, nothing controls me. Yeah, that's what the Quran means by created to jinn from fire, free from smoke. If you see smoke in a fire, that means there's something there attempting to control the fire. If you see no smoke, that means we have no control. Look at what's happening in the world now, governmentally, even religiously, even academically, in the academic circles. These are people who are now just willy-nilly making up rules and regulations that they're forcing people to follow. No ijma in the Muslim world, no democracy in the Western world. Here's what you better do. Here's what your child better get put into his arm, into his system, or he can't go to school. Or you can't shop here, or you can't eat here, or you can't work here, huh? That's the one that does not accept any controls. It's just that it's being made more manifest in this day and time. It's always been an undercurrent attempting to seep out at opportune times. But now they feel like, yo, our plan is here now. Let's just pull the wool all the way off of our sheep body and show them that we're really the wolves, ready to devour them and their future generations. These useless, pitiful humans created from this stinky black mud. Ooh-ee. I'm laughing to keep from crying, trust me. No. Nothing controls me. I am not like that mud fashioned into shape. You see the word mud, they made sure that backwards it spelled dumb. That's what they think about the people made of black mud fashioned in the shape. They are black dummies. I don't have to stay the way things put me. This is fire talking. Nature put him like that, and he has to stay there, meaning clay, until I give him knowledge. But myself, I am a creature of knowledge. I am a creature of fire. No earth controls me. I scatter the forms that are fashioned of mud. I burn a building down. I took the World Trade Building down and reduced it to rubble and dust and fires. And I took a whole forest in Canada and I burnt it to the ground and blew the smoke from that all the way into your country, from Canada. It's all South Carolina and Pennsylvania, New York, New Jersey, Delaware. Yeah, that's Satan at work right there. Start a fire all the way somewhere else and then create a wind. And they got you so dumbed down that you're blaming it on Allah. This must be the judgment of God. No, that's the manifestation and the manipulation of a weird scientist that knows how to use weather modification and everything else, occasion, every other kind of occasion, and then goes on vacation while you suffer. That's what that is. And they ain't finished. They just getting started. Continuing. No earth controls me. I scatter the forms that are fashioned of mud. I break them down. I show their inner parts. I show their composition to the world. So I am the one you made to show the world the composition of this man you fashioned out of mud that stays there. It just stays in place. And I direct him as I please. I break him up and put him together. I'm talking about the ignorant, the unlearned of the world, and the wisest scientists of the world, says W.D. Muhammad. They break up, they manipulate, they break up, they disintegrate, they decompose, they reform the ignorant of the world. You are in their hands. They are your gods until God does something to you. But God says, nevertheless, I know, I have knowledge, ilma, that you do not know, that you do not have. That was Allah's answer to the angels. They said, how are you going to let this guy, you know, he just gonna cause bloodshed and mischief and all that? Allah says, I know what you do not know. What is ilma? It's a superior science. It's not the science that the fire people are operating with. that science that they called from the study of their material environment. How do we know? Right there in Al-Baqarah, Allah says, there was a man who kindled a fire. He didn't get it from on high. He kindled a fire. And when it had lighted all around him, Allah snatched away their light. Not his light, their light. It starts out as an individual. There was a man, meaning a mindset, who kindled a fire. Fires don't start spontaneously like what they're trying to tell you happened in Canada. Stuff just poof, all of a sudden it's on fire and it's rapid and it's running. No. They tell you when you were learning about cavemen and all of that other foolishness in the grade school, they told you man invented fire. Isn't that what they told us? Man, he's rubbing two sticks together and all of a sudden a spark. So a human has to kindle a fire. It's amazing what they've done to this world. Let's continue. So they are your gods until God does something for you. But God says, nevertheless, I know what you do not know. Certainly I know that you have mastered him. This is Allah speaking to the scientists, of the weird scientists, not the correct ones, the corrupt ones. Certainly I know that you have mastered him. Certainly I know you have been his superior and that you have had him in your hands. But I'm not saying that I am going to make simply mud fashioned into shape. I am saying that I am going to make my man from simple mud fashioned into shape. He won't be the thing that you have been handling. But I am going to begin with the most inferior in your power. Oh, please listen to me carefully. I'm going to begin with the most inferior in your power. In this neck of the woods, in this day and time, who has been the most inferior human being walking the planet Earth if it has not been the colored people, the Negro, the so-called black people, those people? They have been the most deprived. This is what Elijah Muhammad was coming to remedy. With his own brand of psychology, the most despised, the most rejected, the most duped people in our day and time has been the people who were brought here for chattel slavery. And all of that is not even the truth. That's a story for another day. But who are these people? People amongst the early Native Americans, the Indians. And so these are people who have been kicked in the pants, taking all the land and stuff and wealth from them and all of that. These are the people who are the black mud fashioned into shape that the Quran is speaking to. And in somebody else's day and time, it was a different people. In the days of the ancient Vedics, it was the Dravidian and other people who were either manipulators or being manipulated. But the theme remains the same. The template remains the same. It just keeps moving and readjusting itself over different people in different situations throughout history. The Quran is recounting all of those times for you. And at the end of it, many times the people become obliterated by their own bad behavior. And don't think it can't happen, or that is not happening in our day and time. Allah is the doer of whatsoever he pleases. He don't care nothing about no American flag. He don't care nothing about no red, black, and green flag. I hope y'all hear me. Allah's not caught up in no flags because you waving a particular banner or something. Oh, those are the safe people. No, that ain't how this goes. What kind of behavior are you waving in front of the people? What kind of behavior are you advertising before people's children and grandchildren? That's the concern of scripture. What kind of word environment are you creating for the minds, these young minds, these innocent minds that are just arriving into the world and are depending on you for guidance? What are you waving before them? That's what scripture is concerned with as we continue. So once you let fire loose, fire has to be controlled. Yeah, this is Allah speaking back to that fire mind. He won't be the thing that you have been handling. But I am going to begin with the most inferior in your power, under your power. And I'm going to begin another creation on him, you see. Thumma khalqan akha. Thereafter, another creation. Whew. You can control him when he's dust. You can control him when he's sperm. You can control him when he's an attached clot. You can control him when he's boned. You can control him when he's flesh. You can control him when he's flesh covering over the bones. You can control him all of the way up to the point of thumm. Khalikin akhar. Thereafter, an akhira creation, an after something that I'm not even going to tell you about because you begin working right away on how to defeat it. This new paradigm that Allah is bringing us into, Shaitan can't even figure out how Allah is doing it. He don't know how Benjamin Bilal or W.D. Muhammad or you, he don't know how this happens in 2023 when most of us were supposed to be defeated by now. You weren't supposed to have an independent mind in this time that we're living in right now. If you understood the real schemes of Shaitan and his shayateen for humanity, all of this would be done deal by now. Most of the people on this planet would be dead. If you understood what his true plans were, those big boys up top, the Rockefellers and the Oppenheimers and all those super duper wealthy billion and trillionaire people, including some of the ones sitting in Saudi Arabia. If you understood what they were planning for many years behind closed doors, that they're now starting to come out front in the front lawn and talking about because they know you're too busy watching Will Smith slap Chris Rock at the same time that they're making these major decisions about your life and your future, economically and socially, politically, academically. So that when your children go to school, they got to read about Tom and Harry being the daddy of Billy. Billy's got two daddies. They got to read that. That's mandatory reading in most of these public schools now. And they're forcing it. They're forcing it on Muslim schools right now as we speak. There are major forums now that are beginning to percolate amongst Muslims. How do we handle this LGBTQ, LSD, MOUSE issue? And now some of you think I'm saying that because you say, oh, he hates homosexuals. No, I don't. I never said that. Homosexuals were here before the LS or whatever the initials are. I don't even know all the letters. Homosexuals are no new thing. I had gay people in elementary school. I'd say gay because they were very effeminate boys. Some of them were my best friends. In high school, some of my best friends. Effeminate, but they weren't trying to push their life on me. Their lives, they never approached me like, will you be my boyfriend? They never, they knew better than that. But we were good friends, went places, climbed mountains and rocks and played softball or whatever people do, you know, volleyball or whatever they like. I was right there with them. This has nothing to do with hating anybody. I leave judgment to Allah. I'm not Allah. You kidding? That ain't what this is about when I mention these organizations. I'm mentioning these organizations because they are politically established with an agenda attached. They're being duped and used just like these so-called black organizations, the NAACP and all the rest of those letters there are being duped to establish a certain agenda because people are paying them to do it. They're paying Black Lives Matter to do what they do. And now all of them are crying broke. After they took the money and built million-dollar mansions and all of that, didn't spend any of it on the people. They spent it on themselves as leaders. Same thing with the NAACP. Why are you still calling yourself colored people in 2023? You other people, why are you still Negroes, United Negro Improvement Association, UNIA, or whatever they're called now, United Negro College Fund, that's it, yeah. You couldn't drop Negro by now? NAACP, you couldn't be the National Association of People of Color. You're still the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People. Where are these colored people? You still want to be known like that? Because the people who are running their agenda are people who don't look nothing like the people who you think are your true leaders. Don't get me started. Anyway. Back to Imam Muhammad's direct words. I get in trouble sometimes when I start coming from my own thoughts, but I love this kind of trouble. I do. I treasure, I cherish this kind of trouble because it's on time. Now, So look at what God said. God said, when I have duly proportioned him, when I have given him his emotional form and have settled him in the right quantity, in the right quality. Haven't I taught on that in the past few months? And that was not after I read this. I'm reading this. I've had it for a minute, given to me by a very beloved fellow learner of yours. I'm not going to tell you who he is because you'll be crushing his email trying to get this document. It's over 1,000 pages of Imam Muhammad's early works. You don't need that volume. Just listen every week to how I present it to you. So going back to his words, he said, look at what God says. God says, when I have duly proportioned him, when I have given him his emotional form and have settled him in the right quantity and the right quality emotionally, and when I have duly proportioned him as a creature of knowledge, and I have given him the right amount and the right quality of knowledge. See, amount is quantity, quality, the quantity and the quality of the knowledge. You only know but so much, so it does have a quantity, but the more important thing about knowledge is how much quality is built into it. Continuing, and when I have established him as a begging, humble, and pleading creature, when I have proportioned means to put the right amount of this and the right amount of that. Thus, when I put the right amount of each of these things that go into the making of my man, then I am going to do something else. This is still God speaking. See, the trouble with you, Satan, is that you are all fire and don't have the other forms. You have grown out of the pleading, the begging, the wanting form. You think that you want for nothing. You think that you have no one to cry to. I'm going to make a man who still has baby in him. Oh, my goodness.
Alhamdulillah.
Yeah. Mm.
Alhamdulillah.
Yeah. How sweet it is, as Imam Muhammad used to say. This is so wonderful.
Even I have to say Alhamdulillah.
All right.
Oh, yeah.
Who is this?
Mahir.
Oh, yeah, of course. Man, your early development is wrapped up in this frequency. Yeah, we'll get a chance.
All of us in this room's frequency is wrapped up.
Yeah.
Or else we wouldn't be here.
This is true. Thank you, my friend.
I'm doing it now.
Yeah. Yes, indeed. So look at what Allah says in the Quran. He says that the ones who will understand the delicate balance between the muhkamat and the mutashabihat, Allah calls them Ulul al-bab. they translate it as people or men of understanding. That's totally corrupt, that understanding. That's not understanding. It's misunderstanding, misguidance. People of understanding. No, they are the ones who say all of it is from Allah. No, those are not the men of understanding. It's ulul al-bab. Ulul means ancient. That's where they get the English word owl from. That's where they get the word owl from, the Arabic word awl and awl. A-W-L, awl means ancient. So ulul al-bab means the ancient lub. And lub is a reference to the heart area that takes blood and it loops it around the body. See, it loops it. Lub, lub, lub. So Allah is saying that none will understand the connections between the so-called fundamental and the so-called allegorical, except the people of the ancient loop, the people of the ancient heart, the people of the oldest heart. What's the oldest heart in the history of your individual development? It's the heart that you came here with as a baby. Ulul al-bab, bab, babe, baby. Yeah, those are the ones who don't have no problem with anything in the Quran. Everybody else got a problem. Except those people. That's a level of understanding that you have to grow into based on the sincere heart that you come into that is like that of the newborn baby, born as a baby of want, growing into a baby of emotions, developing further into a baby of knowledge, a child of knowledge, then an adult that's carrying knowledge, and knowledge dictates that we take on certain elevated responsibilities. Those are the people this is talking about. So continuing, speaking to Iblis, you have grown out of the pleading, the begging, the wanting form. You think that you want for nothing. You think that you have no one to cry to. I'm going to make a man who still has baby in him. He will have the right amount of baby in him. He will still cry to me and say, Father. Isn't that what most people in religion call God? Father God. He will still look at me and call on me as Father. I'm going to make him of knowledge, but he will have the right amount of knowledge in him. He won't be like you. That's what Allah says directly to certain people in the Quran, to people who have abused their power. Allah says he will take it from you and give it to another people, and they will not be like you. That's talking to the Arabs and anybody else in Hadeen who has had the leadership position and have abused it and misused it. Allah says, I will raise up another people. I'm not a racist God. I don't choose ethnic groups. I choose human qualities. And I'm going to, when your quality becomes decrepit and corrupt, I'm going to take the blessings off of you. And I'm going to bestow it on a whole new baby people. And they will not be like you. And behind that, we say, inshallah, because a lot of us have become cuckoo for cocoa pups also, since thinking that we've grown into certain Quranic or Islamic knowledge, following other people who we believe to be the people. It's amazing. Continuing. He won't be proud. He will recognize that he is not the God, that he is not the superior. He won't be unruly like you. He won't be fire that can't be controlled or contained. His fire will have something to contain it. He will have with him the form of submission. And submission pulls by its force of gravity, and it holds the flames down and won't let them escape to do damage. You see how fire likes to rage and rise up? It even separates itself from time to time from the base. But Allah is going to create something that is going to be so fundamentally secure. Yeah. Fundamentally secure. Mute your phones, please, so that no noise bleeds over. Fundamentally secure, that they won't have that problem. They'll know when to rise up and be presentable and auspicious and use etiquette and social graces. And that they'll know when to do all of that, but they can go home and play with the children also. Roll around in the grass with the 7-year-old. They know when to do that also. They're not so high and mighty that nothing down here, they're not concerned about the common people anymore. Common concerns, the concerns of the wife, the concerns of the neighbor. See, those are your earthly social concerns. No, they're going to be concerned about the higher knowledge, the sciences, but they're also going to remain connected to social matters, the material world and its sciences. Imam Muhammed, continuing, says, so he will also be a creature of knowledge that will be duly proportioned in that knowledge and will have quality knowledge. Your knowledge is polluted knowledge. This is Allah talking to Satan. That is why it rages all out of control. Continuing and concluding with Imam Muhammad's words, your knowledge has been polluted by the darkness of your dark being, not being dark in the sense of white and black, like black mud and white chalk, but darkness in the sense of the absence of light. You know, the book says, this is the Bible he's speaking about, that Satan was a black creature. See, a lot of you don't know that's in the Bible, that Satan is a black creature. So many Christians have called Satan the black devil. Then they went on to call him the red devil, but he was known as the black devil first. Continuing. Black here is not black in the physical sense. It is black in a moral sense, black in a spiritual sense, and black in a mental sense. Because the book says his knowledge is blackness, meaning that it is darkness. All right, follow me now. And I guarantee that if you listen, that you will learn. And if you learn, you will become superior in the earth. All right now. So he said, when I have duly proportioned him, when I have put the right amount of baby in him to call upon me, to realize that it needs protection, and that it needs someone to answer its hunger. End quote. So you have just been privy to the first installment of the course that we'll be introducing for semester number 22, beginning around the 1st of July when the semester changes. Yeah, this was session number one, and we'll continue in early July on a different webinar platform other than YouTube, but it will be announced through YouTube. And that will be specifically dealing with the teachings, the language, the logic of Imam W. Deen Mohammed, and the University Online Learning Course, which you're tuned into right now, will be specifically geared towards an understanding of numetics, the understanding of every Arabic alphabet and English alphabet. And I'm going to start introducing some Hebrew and some Greek alphabet so that you can see the corresponding logic in these other languages when you set them up next to the Arabic language. And I'm going to show you how the Arabic corresponds perfectly with things that Allah has created in the fitrah. But several of these other languages have lost that original connection. All languages are connected to nature, but languages become corrupted. Languages become polluted based on who takes control of the people speaking those languages. And that's where we begin to have serious problems in terms of what people communicate to us. The ancient seafaring Phoenicians were known for adopting languages and then changing the meanings of words, and sometimes even forcing those new meanings on new people that they would come in contact with or that other people would conquer. Then people like the ancient Egyptians were known for taking language and giving false connotations to words, to concepts also. And it was for the purposes of fooling the Phoenicians. They didn't want to give up that precious knowledge that they were looking at on the walls of ancient Kemet. Those ancient so-called Egyptians didn't do that. So, you know, Imam Muhammad gave a meaning for Egypt that was using the letter E in Egypt as the I, E-Y-E, and the Egypt as meaning those who were gypping the eyes of the Greeks and the others who were feasting upon those words on the wall and thought they were going to come into some ancient super science. And Egyptians gave them just enough for the city, as Stevie Wonder would say, just enough for the city, just enough for them to remain close enough to help us conquer the rest of these other people. That's what they were using the Greeks and others for. They were fierce enemies to begin with. And then they made a pact, like many people do. Even the ancient Arabs made a pact with the ancient Turks. And a lot of the people right now that you think are actually Arabian, quote unquote, are actually Turkish. But that's a story for another day. It's a long story, so you'd had better be prepared when we go into that subject matter. But we'll be sticking very closely to the meanings of numetics and the letters of these letter systems so that you can better understand practically anything that you read, but particularly the Quran. Now, just a few words about what I just read, and I will bring this up so that you can see it. These are just points that I took that further explain the language and logic that you just became exposed to. In the Surah 6, called El An'am, the cattle, ayah 159, Allah says, Inna alladhina farraqu دينهم وكانوا شيعا لست منهم في شيء إنما أمرهم إلا الله ثم ينبئهم بما كانوا يفعلون. So let's translate this ayah from Surah 6, 159. As for those who divide their religion and break up into sects, as we spoke about earlier, thou hast no part in them in the least. Listen to what Allah is saying. Their affair is with Allah. He will in the end tell them the truth of all that they did. Now, all throughout the history of Imam W.D. Muhammad's leadership, there have been people, particularly from overseas, as Muslims, accusing him of creating a sect in Islam because he was teaching from a particular vantage point in terms of his language and logic, the terminology that he was using. He wasn't quoting from a whole lot of hadith. He had, as he said, a handful of hadith that he would use that he found to be appropriate. A handful. There are imams who say they're under Imam W. Deen Mohammed now. They're picking, they just eeny, meeny, miny, mo their hadiths in these khutbahs I'm listening to. They had one recently. He quoted from a hadith to justify the stoning of adulterers. There's a hadith in Bukhari Muslim volume that says there was a monkey who was accused by his fellow monkeys of adultery. And the other monkeys got together and stoned that one monkey to death. You believe that? That's to convince the knuckle-headed dummies that they have created. That ain't me talking. That's how they talk behind our backs. Don't let me hurt your feelings. I'm only giving you the language that I know they are using behind our backs. These ignorant masses are our asses. That's how they speak about us. That ain't me talking. That's them talking. So they accuse us of being the ones to create sects because Imam Muhammad used the term Bilalian, named after the companion Bilal. He said, okay, our ethnic group, we need a new name. We've been struggling with these names since we've been in this country. We started out niggers. Then they called us colored people. Then they called us Negro people, which is black in Spanish. Then in 1969, because of James Brown's song, Say It Loud, Black and Proud, they elevated, they didn't elevate it. They just changed the language of Negro to black. And that's what Negro means. It means black. They didn't make any, there was no difference. Then we became black. Then Imam Muhammad suggested Bilalian after his father passed, and he came into leadership around 1976. He introduced the term Bilalian. And he drew a comparison between the historical Bilal, who was freed from slavery, set free by the call of Muhammad the Prophet to Islam, to al-Islam, and rose to become the caller to faith. See, that's what Imam Muhammad envisioned for the so-called African-American people who were accepting Islam, and even those who did not accept Islam. He envisioned that even the whole people would become a dignified people who would concentrate their efforts on inviting people to that which was worthy of our human involvement. No matter what you are, from the church, from wherever, from the hood, whatever, Imam Muhammad was appealing to all of the people through what he called the African-American group soul. So he saw that the majority of people were not becoming familiar or accepting of the term Bilalian. So he said, well, then let's just call ourselves African-American, because he wanted us to also identify with the land that we were part and parcel of. He didn't see our issue as being one that necessitated our separating ourselves from the political system here, as his father did, but later changed on. His father later changed his viewpoint on that and began to actually advocate for Muslims to become, and for African Americans, pardon me, to become candidates in many of these political races around the country. Elijah Muhammad supported Adam Clayton Powell. Through Malcolm X, he supported Adam Clayton Powell. He supported other people in important political positions. He was just waiting for us to grow out of the involutionary stage into the evolutionary stage, as I mentioned at the beginning of this discourse. So Bilal was not intended to create a sect. Bilal was intended to create an identity, to fill the void of an identity crisis that we as a people could feel comfortable with. Rising from underground, beneath the sand, they used to bury Bilal. They used to bury him beneath the hot desert sand and call him all kinds of despicable names while he was enslaved to those Arabs at that time. But he rose from beneath the sand to the top of the Kaaba to call the people to human dignity. What a picture of success. So Imam Muhammad chose that picture. But the other leaders among us, the Jesse Jacksons and such, they had under black. Now let's call ourselves African American. So he just went back and chose a word that Imam Muhammad had chosen earlier, as though he was the one presenting African American. And we started calling ourselves African American. Okay. Again, no harm, no foul. But after Imam W.D. Muhammad died, these so-called black leaders went back to calling us black people. And unfortunately, our Muslim Journal was one of those avenues that began going back to calling us black people on the covers of their Muslim Journal magazine, knowing that black is not a fit description for a people with a history and culture and destiny. To call them just by a hue of skin color, black. What is that? You, like I said on many occasions, you don't call your cat just a black cat. You don't call your black dog just a, he's got a name, a Labrador Retriever, a German Shepherd. You don't just call them by colors. A white bird indicate, no, that's a cockatoo, whatever the kind of bird that is. He's got a name. Where's your name? It's just black, white people, so-called, don't just call themselves white. They say, I'm an Irish, I'm German, I'm Polish, I'm Jewish. You ain't never heard a Jewish person call themselves a white person. Ever. Find one. Bring them here. Show me the quote. They know they're not white people. Africans don't call themselves black people. They don't even call themselves Africans. They know that came from the Greeks. You know what Africa means? To divide. It's a command to divide. Look at what Allah says here. And Allah is sending me this. I didn't plan this. Inna alladhina farraqu. You see that? Farraqu. That's where they get the word Africa. And what does it mean? Divide. Those who are divided. Because that's what the European left Europe in order to do to the entire continent of Africa. Divide it up into sections and allow European nations to go for broke in terms of what they could get. After we divide them from themselves, reduce or eliminate their power, as Allah says would happen if you divided yourself into Shi'an. That's what this is about. You reduce your power and people stronger than you can then come in and swoop you up for pennies on the whatever they say. So you are not accurately assigning yourself a dignified name, even when you say New Africa. Imam Muhammad was a man who would resolve on things until the next thing presented itself as an opportunity to go higher than that. How do you know that, instructed Bilal? He kept saying we should establish New Africa. Okay, maybe the sting has been taken out of that connection with Africa, meaning divided. It's from faraka, the verb, the Arab verb, faraka, which means he divided. Imam Muhammad might have seen another way of interpreting that, because it also represents frequencies. But it represents the divisions in frequencies. See, frequent, faraka. Africa, same words, same context of language and logic. So he could have seen that, but he was the one who told us about Africa and how it became divided and how the word Africa meant to divide. That was his early teaching. You'll come across it as I continue it to next semester. But in the absence of the acceptance of Bilalian, he just went back and said, okay, New Africa, at least we can get started there. We can do what we want in the future with whatever we want to do. But people poo-pooed it. They turned it down. They turned their noses up at it. And New Africa still hasn't happened. Not that it won't. I encourage it because we need an independent cultural paradigm to work within, I believe. Not separate from the rest of the nation or the rest of the people or anything. The world has changed since the 70s and the 80s and the 90s when Imam Muhammad was teaching heavily on these ideas. The whole world has changed. New people, many new people, like they're saying that the African American is no longer the largest ethnic group in America. I think they say it's now the Latinos. We were like 35 million. They say they're like 40 million, 45 million Latinos now. And with the influx of folks, over the border, past, whatever, we don't know what the numbers are. And you don't even know whether you can actually trust the people who are counting the numbers for you and giving them to you. Found out recently that this whole thing about African Americans bringing in $1.3 trillion a year, that wasn't true. That wasn't true. Not the way they presented it to us. So we got to be real careful with the source of information that we've been depending on. So let's take it easy as I say these words and then hand the microphone over to those of you who want to speak. Now, this tells you to be very careful of those who break up your deen into sections. So right away, I have to be suspicious of those who say Sunni Islam or Shia Islam or whatever other kind of Islam, or Hanafi, Hanbali, Maliki, Shafi. I have to be careful now because those are sections who do things very different than the next section. They like to criticize the people who say, well, we need to look at this whole thing about the Salat in a different light. We need more information on that because it might not be this ritual prayer thing that they've been trying to tell us it is. No, brother, then you're going against the Quran. The Quran says, establish the Salat. Okay, where are the details for that? In the Hadiths, okay, let's go to the Hadiths. Is there any Hadith out of the 7,000 or something that have been accepted? Are there any single Hadith that give us all of the things we're supposed to do? It's only 5 minutes worth of action. Is there any Hadith that gives us everything we're supposed to do from calling the Adhan first and then standing up and then takbir with our hands here and our thumbs on our earlobes? That's what they told us in Sunni Islam and only in particular schools of thought within Sunni Islam. That's there. And then they say, bring it into Qiyam, standing position. And some will say, put your hands here up near the chest area. Some will say, no, only the women should hold their hands up here. Men should hold their hands over here above their navel. Then another school of thought says, no, men should hold their hands beneath the navel. Then another school of thought, the Maliki school, says, no, we should hold our hands straight down on our sides. Not knowing that Maliki was tortured so much by the people who wanted to see him off the set that they used to beat his arms. And that's the reason why he kept his to the side. But the people looking at him and emulating him and following him, that became their method for the Salat. Then you have other people who say different things during the gestures. Some, you know, say that you got some who, when they close out and you, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, there's some who only say it to the right. You don't say it to the left. Then you got another school of thought that say it both ways. Then you got the Shia who say something altogether different. So which Salat are you speaking about that we should be following because the Quran says perform the Salat? How come the Quran doesn't give you step by step? Like I said, it's not that many movements. How come the Quran gives you step by step for making ghusl? Wash your feet up to the elbow, up to the ankle. It gives you steps for making ghusl. How come it doesn't give you steps for making Salat? These are serious questions that are being reinvestigated by many of our sincere scholars right now as we speak. Most people, as I told my daughter and her mom this morning, don't realize that in the last few years, the majority of the scholarship in Saudi decided to reinvestigate every single hadith that has been accepted as acceptable. Meaning the volumes of Bukhari, Muslim, Abu Dawud, and so forth, the ones that we see as being safe, even though they contain da'if hadith, meaning weak hadith, even though they contain hadiths like the one I told you about the monkey being stoned to death for adultery, that's in the volumes of Bukhari and Muslim, the acceptable hadiths. They set out a few years ago when they got this new prince guy over there, he commissioned them to reinvestigate every single hadith and to separate out the ones that were, as they said, causing problems for the Muslim world. Yeah, especially the ones regarding women that the Prophet saw into the, when Allah sent him on the journey, the night journey, he said he visited heaven, he visited hell, and then he visited heaven. You know about the heaven part, but you don't read the hadith about when he visited hell. He said the majority of its inhabitants were women. And he said, what was the reason for the majority of men, of women being in the hell? He said, because they disobeyed their husbands. That's what I mean by them seeing us as dummies. Black mud, mud spelled backwards, dumb, black, ignorant, ignorant dummies. fashioned into a sunnah, masnoon. That means into the place of sunnah. They created a sunnah from dummies who were in the dark. And Allah said, when I have breathed into him of my ruh, then make sajda in his direction. It was so beautiful when you understand it. So don't expect to get the kind of respect in the world that you're looking for Muslims until you have accepted to be breathed into. If you really want to know what that means, study breathing techniques. Don't be afraid to visit the yogis and see what they say breathing is, how to cleanse your lungs. What is breathing? What happens inside the body as you breathe? What's the difference between breathing in and when you breathe out? What's the difference between breathing in through the nostrils and breathing out through the mouth? What's the difference? Ask a martial artist. They'll be able to break it down for you. Allah just lays the template for you in the Quran. You're supposed to investigate the minutia and then apply the minutia in whatever way best situates your situation. Allah doesn't make anyone stamp and say everybody in the whole world got to do it this exact way. No, that's why the details, he gives enough detail to provide the blueprint and the template. And then according to your conditions and circumstances, got some places in the world that don't see daylight for 2 weeks. How are they going to follow the 5 daily prayer thing and the fasting thing during the daylight hours and breaking it when the sun goes down? They'd be breaking fast every 2 weeks and then fasting for 2 weeks straight. That doesn't even make sense. Allah revealed this to a human being that could think, could reason, could rise above emotions. Let me continue and get us out of here. So when Allah says that he will tell them the truth of all that they did, see, he will in the end tell them the truth of all that they did. When Allah says that, he uses a word from the root word naba, yunabbi'uhum, from naba. There's a surah by that name, an-naba'a, and they translate it as the great news. Listen to this carefully. Naba'a means to tell someone something of consequential importance. It's not just news. There are a lot of words for the dispensing of information, including the word hadith in the Quran. Allah says that the Quran itself is ahsanul hadith, the most excellent hadith or report. But there's about another at least 3, 4, 5 words that can be translated as information or news. Musa was given a word that meant news. Others were given other words that meant news. But naba'a means news that is of consequential importance. So it would be the difference between sharing the weather report concerning an 85-degree sunshiny day like we had down here in Raleigh and telling someone that a major hurricane will be hitting will be hitting us this afternoon. See, one of them you consider just to be talk. Oh, 85 degrees? Oh, nice. I might go to the beach in a few hours. But if they didn't tell you that, what difference would it make if you didn't know from your friend or your relative that it was going to be 85 degrees today and sunny? That's not consequential news. But if they say, hey, I just learned that there's a major storm brewing and it's going to be here by 3 o'clock. It's 9 o'clock now. We had better batten down the hatches around this place, put some boards up in front of the windows. There's going to be 125-mile winds coming through here this afternoon and rain. And you got to prepare. You hear that kind of news, you, whoa. Because the consequences of not listening means that you don't know which actions to take to save yourself. That's why the word naba'a, this kind of consequential news, that's what makes it great. And the word nabi, which they translate as prophet, the prophet is not coming to bring ordinary information to ordinary people. He's coming to bring extraordinary consequential information to equally extraordinary humans, to bring out the extraordinary in the human. If that human would pay heed. See, that's the key. Those who do not pay heed, Allah says he put ayat, instructing signs in the skies, and an ayat, instructing signs in the earth. And in you, he put similar ayat, but Allah said most people go on heedless. See? So they cancel themselves out. You can't even blame Big Pharma in the conspiracy theories and the Rockefeller. You can't even blame them. blame yourself for not listening to the instructions. That's why Allah is the best to judge, not us. So Naba demands that actions be taken. Whenever you read a statement in the Quran that's being pronounced by the Prophet, Ya ayyuhal ladina, Ya ayyuhal nabi, when Allah is speaking to the Prophet to say something or do something, pay attention, because that's consequential. Us being the followers of the Quran, if we don't pay attention to that particular level of advice, we are going to be in trouble eventually. Let's continue. We have arrived at that day and time where the death knell has been sounded on sectarianism in Islam. And I put Islam in quotation marks because it should be al-Islam as Imam Muhammad established it. I should say as the Quran establishes it. The Quran gives it a definite article, al-Islam. So we're in that day and time when the seasons have changed, the seasons have shifted, the cosmic seasons have shifted from what they call the Piscean age to the Aquarian age, the age of the water bearer. So there's going to be tons of water poured out. That's what the internet is doing. It's just pouring out information, tons of it, because we're in the age of Aquarius. If you only understood what that means, Pisces is the age of the inverted fish, meaning that during that, 2,600 years of the Piscean cosmic age, that was the period of time when people who were opposite each other were establishing their ideologies and psychologies and religions and all of that. That's the era when all of these denominations appeared out of Catholicism. Then the Baptists showed up, and the Methodists showed up, and the Episcopalians showed up, and the Jehovah's Witness showed up, and then it runs into hundreds of denominations. There was al-Islam as the Prophet taught it, and then in the same era, now we're talking the last 2,600 years, the Prophet came in that period. So as soon as he left, they started bussing that up into sects. So the Quran is speaking against that because Allah knew that era produces that or would produce that. So now here we are. Online, Sunni Muslims calling themselves Black Muslims, addressing Black Muslims. You can't find anything better than that to call yourself Black Muslims. If the white Muslims turned around and started giving lectures on YouTube called for white Muslims only, you'd have a hissy fit. And they're not saying Black Muslims like they're Nation of Islam Black Muslims. They got that term from the Black Muslims of the Nation of Islam. But Sunni Muslims are calling themselves Black, the Black Muslim Forum, the Black Muslim Conference, the Black. I looked and I said, well, this must be Minister Farrakhan or, you know, one of the other Nation of Islam groups. No, this is so-called Sunni, thobed down, turbaned up in sandals and whatever. You know, I'm exaggerating a little bit, but you get my point. Who would have ever thought that they would have been reduced to the black mud stage? This is very serious business. That's why it's Naba'a. Consequential news in the end. So Muslims must recognize that there is no such thing as Sunni, Shi'i, and the other sects, which this deen has been purposely broken up into within the last 1300 years at least. It actually began happening during the time of our Prophet, close to 1500 years ago, where Muhammad is quoted in the Quran itself as appealing to his Rabb. And said, my Rabb, my people have abandoned this Quran. They've taken it and just trashed it behind their backs. That was in his day and time. It got captured by Allah and put into the Quran for all time, for us to learn from that. My people, my qawm, meaning my ethnic group, these Arabs that I'm around every day who say they love me. This is the best thing that has happened to us since sliced bread. Yeah, he said, my qawm have abandoned this Quran, not the Quran, this had al Quran, this the Quran. So you would make no mistake about it. And then they sought to preserve everything that wasn't the Quran to tell you that you need that along with the Quran. That's how you abandon the Quran, by saying that the Quran is not fully detailed. You need these men involved to explain to you what has been left unexplained by Allah in the Quran, even though he says it's fully detailed and that he has left nothing out of the book. No, don't worry about that part of what Allah is saying. Just go to this other part that we're saying. That's also sectioning off the wisdom and the knowledge of the Quran. That's what creates these sections. when people say promote this part of the Quran. That's what Christians did with Christianity. Promote this part of the Bible, the part about the crucifixion. No, promote the part where Jesus gets baptized and we'll be Baptists. No, promote this part where Jesus provides a certain methodology and we'll call ourselves Methodists. No, promote this part where Jesus said that we are one world, that when he returns as Christ, he's coming to take over the whole world, and we'll call that Catholic. Catholic means worldwide, universal. We're here to take over. The Pope will tell you that Catholicism is intended to wipe out all other religions and establish itself as the one world religion. But you don't talk to people enough to find that out. I talk to people. I listen to people when they talk and get interviewed and that kind of thing and get questions like that, or the things that they might say in private that end up spilling out into the public. You can tell the intent of just about anything by evaluating the name. So this deen, which should properly be called al-Islam, has been broken up into sects within the last 1300 years. I believe that one of the minds of our day and time who was missioned to institute this dismantling of artificial divisions that we call sects was Imam W. Deen Mohammed. Now that's just my belief. You don't have to, please don't. Tag my little videos and put your comments. You see, this is why Wallace was a devil. This is why you are. Please, my mellow, relax. Find another video to troll and create confusion. I said, this is my belief. I believe. See? I believe.
And it's my belief too.
I know it is. I'm speaking as your representative right now. Yeah, man, I understand. Many of you out there. Right. So I believe that one of the minds, not all of them, not the only one of the minds of our day and time who was missioned to institute this dismantling of artificial divisions was Imam W. Deen Mohammed. But I'll scale it down a little. I'll say I believe many of the people I've been dialoguing with in the last year or so, including your Omar, Ramahi and your Omar, why am I messing up these names now? You know who I'm talking about, Omar Zaid. These people, I believe, are gifted by Allah. They're being blessed by Allah. And many of the ones I'm watching on YouTube, these people are gifted. These are not ordinary minds talking to us in this age of Aquarius. You might think they're ordinary. My ears are trained differently. My ears were tuned by Imam Muhammad's frequencies. So I know like frequencies when I hear them, even though they've never met each other, they don't study each other's works. It doesn't mean that Allah cannot create an attraction on that same level of frequency that draws the right people in the right time towards that frequency. And Allah is Lord of all the frequencies. El Alameen, all the dimensions, all of the frequencies. The concentration for people of faith is on good deeds, and deeds are actions. We want to stay far away from evil deeds. These are Quran teachings. The word deed, we're going to go into some nunetics now. The word deed, D-E-E-D, is consonantally connected to the word dead, D-E-A-D. And dead means that a living form's life force has become discontinued. A living form, its life force has become discontinued. That's what dead means. When we do good, the life force of evil becomes discontinued or deadened. You get it? And when we do evil, the life force of goodness becomes discontinued or deadened. So dead can be positive or negative. The Quran's word for dead is mate. M-A-Y-T, and mayt gives us the English words moot, M-O-O-T, as well as mute, M-U-T-E. It comes from the Arabic word that you can find in the Quran on many occasions called mayton or mate. Mute, English word, means that the expression of the entity is no longer being allowed. See, the expression is no longer being allowed, and that is exactly what death means in scripture. It means that it's a life force and its expression, its ability to express itself, is being disallowed. So when you see a person who's a mute, they call them a deaf mute. I don't like that term, but they call people deaf mutes because the mute cannot express him or herself vocally, especially. So they have to use sign language or, you know, that kind of thing. That's mute. Their voices have been muted out, deadened. And that's what death means. When you come across the word made, substituted for mute. When you come across the word made in the Quran, substituted for moot. Moot means that a thing becomes a non-issue. A non-issue. Look at what Allah says in the third surah, 144th ayah. Muhammad is no more than an apostle. That's another word for messenger. Many were the apostles that passed away before him. If he died or were slain, will you then turn back on your heels? If any did turn back on his heels, not the least harm will he do to Allah. But Allah, and they put in brackets on the other hand, will swiftly reward those who serve him with gratitude. El Shakirin. Allah will reward the Shakirin. Muhammad as a Rasul, which is what this ayat calls him. وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ. It doesn't say النَّبِي. It doesn't say Muhammad is no more than a prophet. It says Muhammad is no more than a messenger. Listen carefully. Muhammad as a messenger is speaking about the message he was missioned to carry, not to his physical existence as a mortal being. Listen to this one more once. When Allah says in this ayah that Muhammad is no more than a messenger, it means that Muhammad is no more than a message. How do we know that, instructed Bilal? Because of the way the word or the name, if you see it as a name, Muhammadun is phrased. It's given a definite article at the end of it. If it were a person, it would say al-Muhammad, like as-Siddiq. But it says Muhammadun, which makes whatever Muhammad is generic. It means literally any Muhammad, anybody who's doing what Muhammad does or was destined to do. What Muhammad is this? The one who is but a message, a messenger. This is talking about what these people did to the message, not to the body. Same thing with Jesus the Christ. That's why the Quran had to come behind that and say they neither crucified him nor killed him, but it was made to appear as such. And the Quran calls Jesus a kalima min Allah, a word from Allah. And the Bible calls Jesus the word of God. So what was crucified? It wasn't the physical Jesus. It was the word that he represented that was crucified. What's the greater fatality? If you kill a physical person and the message lives, or if you kill the word and the understanding of that word becomes deadened in the minds and hearts of the population? The worst is if you kill the word, you crucify the word, there you got him, because you were angry that he was able to espouse the message. Same thing with Muhammad. The ancient Arabs of his time did not hate him. They loved him. They called him their son. They loved Muhammad. Everybody called him Muhammad to mitigate their disputes. All kinds of reasons they called him Muhammad. They didn't have any problems with Muhammad. They had a problem with the message that Allah had given to Muhammad. That's why they wanted him Vamoosed. So Muhammad as a Rasul is speaking about the message he was missioned to carry, not to his physical existence as a mortal being. The physical and social being is Muhammad as a prophet, a Nabi, the one who brings consequential news, as we mentioned earlier. That's when Allah calls him Nabi, ya ayyuhan Nabi. Now he's talking about the prophet as a social being. How he was in the society with his neighbors, how he was with his wives, how he was with his family members, how he was as a community leader. Those are what Allah is addressing whenever you see Nabi mentioned in the Quran. Go research it for yourself. Just look up all of the ayat that have Nabi attached, and you'll see that it's always addressing Muhammad in a social construct, and it is also addressing him as a mortal, it's sometimes fallible, human who made mistakes and needed to be corrected by the guidance of Allah. But Allah never corrects anything that's under the title of Rasul, his messenger. The messenger can do no wrong. Why? Because the messenger is the message, and it's from Allah. It's not from Muhammad. Muhammad, as a Nabi, made certain errors, minimal as they were, but they were errors. And Allah corrected him right there, sometimes on the spot. Allah put the correction in the Quran for him. But wherever you see it mentioned, the messenger, it never speaks about the need for some alteration or correction in the messenger, meaning the message. They know in Arab-speaking lands that the word Rasul can also be applied to the mailman. He's just bringing the message. He didn't write the mail. If you open it up and you find something distasteful, is something you don't want to agree with, he didn't pen the message. He just delivered the message as he was assigned to because of the job he took on. So he was like the postman. I got it here, rain, sleet, snow, you know how they used to say. And now it's on you, partner. You, that's your mail. You deal with the one who sent it to you, not with me, cursing down the street, riding around in your little mail truck because of the news I got from the letter you put in my box. I didn't write the letter. I just delivered it. That's why there's no criticism for the messenger. It'd be like criticizing the postman after he delivered your message in your mail. So the essential message with the Quran or within the Quran is not focused on the physical lives and deaths of anybody. Its primary focus is on the life and death of the message itself. And it actually spans the gamut of so many corresponding levels of information. Is it addressing our physical lives and physical concerns on one level, but on the level of those lives as a template for much more consequential levels of human life, much more consequential. So keep that in mind, that when you read about them killing somebody or even battling with people, and so many people died, it's not just a reference to a physical war, the Battle of Badr and such. It's referencing connections to higher, more consequential actions and ideas that need to be thought about and registered in the intellect, especially. Because the most consequential, as I mentioned, is not the life and death of an individual. It's the life and death of the message that that individual was missioned to provide to the people. It speaks about whether you will turn on your heels if the messenger is made mate, if the messenger is deadened. So what is that saying? If the message becomes muted out. Oh, they began working on that one not long after the prophet passed. In fact, they began working on it while he was alive, as I mentioned earlier. They have abandoned this Quran, so said Muhammad. And that statement was captured by Allah in the Quran itself. My people have abandoned this Quran. What does that mean? That they weren't teaching from the Quran. They were teaching from their own heads, or they were teaching from some other advantage or some other ideology that was opposed to the message of the Quran. It doesn't mean the Quran wasn't existing. It means that the Quran was being muted out. If you take the remote control and mute out a YouTube video that you're watching, it doesn't mean that it can't speak. It's not speaking. It's not playing. It means that you, by your own efforts, muted the sound out. So until somebody grabs a remote from you and say, hey, man, I was learning from that. Let's bring that voice back up. Now, come on. Now, you can learn just from what they're doing. You don't have to hear it, do you? I'd like to see it and hear it. Give me that mute button. And you bring the sound back up. So we're living in the age where the sound is being brought back up on the Quran. It's really that simple. And I said that I believe that a major impetus for that began with the advent of Imam W.D. Muhammad into and onto American soil. That's what I believe. So it says, will you turn on your heel? Let's look at that. The heel is the lowest part of the foot, and it is in touch with the material earth. Now look at consonantally connected words. If you step in a hole, see, heel, hole, H-O-L-E, you will most likely drop down to the lowest depths of its enclosure. You put your foot into a shoe, your heel is going to be at the bottom of that object. If you step into a hole, then again, your feet, your legs, and your body might be at the bottom of that enclosure. Hell, heel, hole, hell, same continental connections. And hell is said to be the lowest level of punishment for those who were disobedient to the rules and laws established by the Creator. Turning on one's heels could also be referring to those who pivot. They pivot in the direction of their material appetites, see, the earth. That's where your heel is seeking its establishment, in the earth, on the earth. So those who pivot from what Allah is establishing for their mental, moral, and spiritual development, they turn away from that for material advantages. Oh, how supremely wise Allah is in what He's giving us in the Quran to ponder. So in this is not only the action that they took in turning away from the guidance of Al-Quran, but Allah is also indicating the purpose or the intent behind them turning away from the guidance of the Quran. And it's the same intent for those who hid the Quran behind their backs. It was to chase what later came to be called the booty. They were chasing the booty, which came to mean wealth. But in the African-American paradigm, it came to mean women's backsides. That's been our downfall. Not all of us. Too many. I can't even say us. Some of them, some of y'all, not even y'all in this audience, but some of them outside who will be hearing this on YouTube, they're busy right now chasing other booty. They made all kinds of songs about it. Shake, 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 you know. Even though that wasn't us per se, but you know what I mean. Shake your body down to the ground. Shake your booty down to the ground. So they had us shaking the booty and chasing the booty. Do the dog. Walking the dog. I mean, they've been calling us dogs in music since the 50s, and they're still chasing the wealth, and they're still chasing the flesh, and ignoring the more important development that Allah created for human life to function by and function with. So pivoting in the direction of their material appetites, because the earth is it's magnetic. It's pulling your feet. Your feet are attracted to the earth. You can't move. You can't walk. You can't make advancements until your feet make contact with the earth. You remember what Allah told Musa in the Valley of Tuwa? He said, remove your sandals. Remove that which is separating your natural feet from the earth. Remove your sandals. No in-betweens, no go-betweens. You don't need an intercessor, because I'm going to put you in touch with a message that will allow for the natural development of your material life to also make advancements. And guess who took advantage of that? The people of Moses. I don't think I have to say anything more about that. They took full advantage of that. How to be materially successful while holding on to our spiritual concepts and ideology. At the same time, we can be healed. See, that's another HL sound word. We can be healed through our heels by a knowledgeable reflexologist. If you don't know what a reflexologist is, look that word up. If so, our lives can then become whole again. How about that HL word? Silent W. Whole. All of these words are part and parcel of each other's meanings. Maybe our life can even become halal. Ah, whole, halal. Heal, but also hell, if you don't treat it right, if you don't give it the proper respect. So that's the end of my rants and notes. So I'm going to allow for just a few people to make some commentary. I'm going to invite Mahir, if he's still with us, to be the first one to give some commentary. We're not going to do anything extended or extensive, but I'm looking at those of you who normally are with us and that people look forward to contributing in this manner. So Mahir, I see you in the queue. Brother, are you ready to make some comments?
Yes, sir. First of all, thank you, Master Teacher.
Alhamdulillah.
And I want to greet everyone. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
And I'm going to be brief. You have taught much, and I love this style of teaching. And yes, just like yourself, I have always been aware that the major issue with those outside of the scholarship of our late Imam W, Deen Mohammed, they didn't contest it, they were more along the lines of just trying to get people to disregard that level of teaching. And I just want to hone in on something regarding Shaitan. And we know in Surah Al-Araf, which has been frequently mistranslated to give people the wrong idea about a particular type of resurrection, they have left people to believe in the ayat, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, that ayat 14 in most people's Quran, and I'm just going to read it here in English, but I'm going to elaborate slightly on the last word in that ayat. So they're saying, he said, Paula, okay, respite me. That's not what that, infirni is not the word for respite or to give someone time. There's a different Arabic word for giving time. That isn't it. And the root verbs, the roots in this word, nadara, is the verb to have vision, to see something. And also, yes, in the same Arabic-speaking countries and other countries with related dialects, the roots of this word is in what you call in America optometrists, those who study and help to correct one's vision.
Beautiful.
Okay, so I you know, I could not miss that part. Yeah. So he is saying, he didn't say respite me, because the aleph is in front of the main part of that word in that ayat. So he said, in thirni, intensive form.
Yeah.
So he is speaking out to say, I'm going to take a look at them. I'm going to look at them. Now, those who have had dealings with the law enforcement in this country, folks, when they say, step over here for a minute, I want to take a look at you, yeah, that means lay hands on you.
Right.
Okay, I'm going to jack you up. Mm-hmm. I'm going to do something to you. And following, he said, until the day, this is how they translate it, when they will be raised up. Mm-hmm. That is not a akhirah type of resurrection or day of Yom Kiyama. That's not what that is. He is saying he's going to keep jacking people up until they throw off his wiles, until they get themselves together. And there's another ayat in another surah that backs that up, which is the Arabic word baqa, which means we have evolved to the level of spiritual development where he can say whatever he wants to say. And mind you, we're going back to this word, the jinn and the nas, and mind you, they're all men. You're dealing with aspects of men. You,
yes, put,
you know, women in there. But the main word for a man or someone who is bipedal, who stands up on their hinds, is rajulun. Mm-hmm. And you know in Hebrew is raglin.
That's right.
And it's also still the same word for foot soldier, infantry. So you have different types of men mentioned in Quran beyond talking about Adam, talking about Nas, talking about jinn. There are several other classifications of men, including the ones whom Allah has exalted, and some of the terms that you use tonight covers that. Okay? So yeah, they're men, but they're on a much higher and elevated platform. So the ones that Iblis, on what it, and that's not his name. That's an intensive, remember, Ublis, Jubilees, okay, Iblis. Yes. So Iblis is he intensive form. He's speaking out of turn. He doesn't care what the ground rules were. He sees it as Allah has kicked him off to the side, which is in the same surah Al-Araf, before we even get to this ayat that I was elaborating on a minute ago. He said, Ana minu khairun. Well, you know, Al-Khairi is one of Allah's attributes, which means what? Bountiful, prosperous, prosperity. So based on his, being locked into the world that he's in, which is how the Greeks and the Romans and others saw themselves as a dominating force, and this influence is still here today. Greek philosophers did not deal with, and they were called doctors.
Yeah.
Okay? Today, they're not called a doctor, per se. But they were seen as the doctors. They didn't believe in the unseen. So they didn't believe in anything that their eyes and their hands, they couldn't lay hands to, nor could they touch. And there's another aspect, the dark side of their philosophy. Yeah. And the philosophy went this way. That while they're here living, which explains the debauchery and other levels of stuff that we should not be engaged in, that they should go throughout the lands and sample and experience all the flowers that are out there. And then here's where the phrase comes in. This is out of the Apocrypha, which used to be part of the King James. So the next, in that same verse, it says, for when we are dead, we're dead. They don't believe that there's something else beyond. They don't believe that there is a reckoning, a balancing of the books, the scale.
Yeah. Yeah.
So they're not dealing with the loop. No, right. That's not right. What they're dealing with.
Right.
And incidentally, when you go to get your car and get his monthly checkup, what's it called?
That's right.
You're going to get it looped, right?
Job. That's right?
So the baby coming into this world
has
all of the proper fittings installed within that allows it to continue to function.
Oh,
this is Allah's way. So now you have to continue to be fluid so that your main parts don't get worn down ahead of time, because you have the normal natural death. And then you have the untimely death. So here it is. You wasn't supposed to show up here in front of Allah, although he knows it all, 10 or 20 years down the road. And now you're going to get questioned. Why are you here right now? What did you do to circumvent or short circuit
the loop?
The loop. Oh, you didn't get your loop jobs. Okay, and you knew because he gave the instructions on how to exactly carry that out. Wonderful. And if you couldn't do it, seek out an ul-bab.
Yes.
Okay, that's someone who does know. And bab represents a gatekeeper or doorway. Yes.
Bab.
So that's right. Another backside that's of right. That. So I'm trying to keep it brief. So let's get back to this one. He spoke out. And you know, I have to kind of correct myself for a second here. Based on how I started out with this ayat. Okay, so Allah says, he said, you know, that's general. And it can apply to anyone speaking out in tyranny. Because, you know, we're not careful, you'll have someone. You'll have someone pinning it or trying to say it's the guy with the horns dressed in a red suit with a pitchfork. And then we go chasing off a spook that's not Allah's intended purpose. So the last word in this ayat, I'm back to this ayat again, does not signify al-akhirah, but your inside. And I just want to read this little piece of tashir because it is in line. It says the resurrection referred to in this verse is not the great resurrection of mankind decreed for the hereafter, but the spiritual resurrection of man, or the state when his spiritual consciousness becomes fully developed.
Yeah.
Iblis can lead him astray only so long as he is not spiritually resurrected. But once he attains the high spiritual knowledge, the spiritual stage, which is known by the term baqa, rebirth, Iblis can do him no harm.
Lovely.
And you know, we've seen relevance in pieces of that. So again, I've really enjoyed the program, and from the beginning until the part also while you were in the speaking, you said so many things. I can't do it justice in 5 minutes.
That's why you're going to have your own seed cast.
unraveled it, because I think, and here's my comment I want to say on this, because now it's becoming clearer to me Dr. Omaze, your platform, and others that come into our circle, so to speak, because it's a sacred circle.
Indeed.
Allah has already arranged it and fixed it. Sunnah, he created it. He created the Fitrullah and he put us in it. But he gave us the instructions on how to be in it, how to conduct ourselves in it. He didn't say we have to be monks. He said he didn't even decree that. So it's not about brothers and sisters becoming monks and nuns. He said, yeah, that might be something if you want to live a monastic life. But he says, know this. He didn't decree that.
That's right.
All right. I want to say again, thank you for this very enlightening part here. And also, I want to leave everyone, it says in Surah Al-A'raf, again, ayat 35. This is about Rasul.
735.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. O children of Adam, if messengers, Rasulin, plural, mm-hmm. such as our late teacher, Imam Deen Mohammed, bearing the message, but here's what he say, come to you from among yourselves, rehearsing my signs unto you, then whoso shall fear Allah and do good deeds, on them shall come no fear, nor shall they grieve.
Wow.
So that's how I'm going to end this.
Well, thank
with
you.
That right there. It's right on point. Because everything you said with that, wonderful. With bearing the message,
yes.
And from among ourselves, he didn't say strangers.
That's right.
Someone speaking to you in a strange code. As a matter of fact, Allah even addresses that with the language of how the Quran was revealed. You know, he said that. He said, if this was revealed in any other, they said tongue, which is correct, which could be dialect. Other than this, he said, then surely they would have said, they would have had a case.
Yeah.
You know, against this message coming.
We don't speak that stuff. He's talking. That's right.
And they said, well, if you would only change some of it, then we can come and believe and be on your side. But Allah says, take not their Islam.
Right.
As a favor to you, but keep this al-Islam, which is the one he has given him.
Beautiful points.
I'll say on that note, salam alaikum.
Oh my goodness. Alaikum salam. Alhamdulillah for that and for you, brother. I thank Allah for bringing you into this circle. We're going to expand this circle. Yeah, what y'all think about that?
Yeah, you can respond.
All right. Okay. Yes, if there's anyone else want to speak, this would be the time to chime in. Alaikum salam, Hassan Abdullah. Go right ahead.
Yes, sir. I'm thankful to be a member of this family and to hear this powerful universal teaching for the benefit of humanity injected into the world atmosphere through the Nation of Islam through involution, and it's still evolving. And Brother Imam Nunez got doing is making it possible for to speak intelligent language for amongst all human beings, because it's the nature. I rest my kids, and like the brothers say, we got the ribbons and womb that bore us. Ain't nobody going to give us nothing. We already got what we need. We got the word of God, the vision, and the desire to make it happen.
All right.
And we got to go forward with that. Appreciate it.
Salam alaikum. All right, we got to go quick now. Go back to back now. If you have something to say, open up your mic and let's get it done. Chime in. Now, there might be some trying to get in who I might have blocked out. I don't know. Let me just double check my mute. I had muted everyone out at one point. Give me just one moment. Let me check that. No, you can unmute yourself, so come on. And if not, then it's my time to close out. It's that simple.
Assalamu alaikum. Alaikum
salam. Okay.
I have a question.
Go right ahead.
There was one section where you were talking about the Rasul and the Nabi, and I think that in our normal understanding of Rasul and Nabi, that Nabi takes primacy over Rasul. But that's not what you're saying, is it?
I think you're saying that.
And I think maybe Allah is saying, subhanahu wa ta'ala, I never thought about it this way before. but there may be a greater emphasis on the message and the messenger than on the prophethood. Would you say that that's true? Comment on that, please.
Well, as far as I can best discern, I can't make that statement that is like an elevated position of the Rasul over the Nabi. They're part and parcel of the same experience, because the message needs to be carried by someone who, in this case, would be the messenger. But to be a messenger, you have to also have the properties of what the prophet has. See, when you get deeper into the study of nunetics, a lot of these confusing ideas are going to be cleared up for you almost overnight, because the nun bait letters are what we're talking about when it comes to the good news or the consequential news that we spoke about, naba'a, right? And naba'a, the consequential news, not ordinary news, not just today's forecast, but the big storm that's coming. That's naba'a. That's great news. That's consequential news that if you don't know about it, you're going to get mowed over. You're going to be in trouble if you don't get this news, right?
Left behind.
All right. That's from the noon bait connection, naba'a. And the word prophet is from that same root letter connection, noon bait, nabi. Okay. So we can't say that the nabi is of lesser concern or lesser importance, if you will, than the Rasul. It's another role. It's another step in the development of a Nabi, but it's as consequential in the delivering of the message. It's like saying, take this message, but you don't give it to a person. The truck is not going to deliver it. It's get the person in the truck. You're delivering the morning's mail or newspaper. You know, your bicycle doesn't throw the newspaper onto the porch. The person has to throw, but you served the purpose of delivering the message is the point. So we don't want to get into whether one is more consequential or more important or less important or anything like that. Now, the thing is, even when Adama, notice how I'm pronouncing his name. I didn't say Adam, as the scholars give it to us, with the medda over the aleph. Every time you see them talk about Adam, they say Adam. Medda means I can stress that aleph out right in my head. I can say Adam if I want to, because they were trying to emphasize the noun called Adam. But Allah never presents the word Adam in that fashion. He always says Adama. He presents it as a verb. An action word. I checked every single place in the Quran where Adama was used, and it always said Adama or Adamu. That's an action word. Your father, Adama, is an action, not a person. See, once you conclude that he's a person, now you got to give him a nationality. And that's where things begin to go awry. See, oh, he was an ancient Jew. He was a Hebrew. No, he was an Arab. No, our father Adam was from the Mesopotamian area of the bones that were found 5,000 years. See, now you get all crazy trying to find a person who's actually an action that's a template that can fit over anybody who follows that action. Because if you are Banu Adam, the children of that Adama, then it means that you are only his children, so to speak, his, so to speak, because you're following in the footsteps of that action. And Allah said to the so-called angels, make sajda to Adama, to that action. So what else did he say to Adama? He said, tell them their names. I'm giving you their concocted translations now. Don't take me too seriously when I give you these translations. He said, tell them their names. And he told them their names, all of them. But what's the word for name? Asma'a. That's number one. But what's the name for tell them? It's from the same root, that same noon bait root, NB root that I was telling you. You understand? So scholars say that's what made Adam a prophet. That's their logic for that. Because Allah didn't call him a prophet. He didn't call him a Nabi, but he did say to deliver this word, and he used the same root word for prophet, and therefore they assumed that Adam was a prophet, and which means what? You're back to thinking that he was this individual in history, created 7,000, 10,000, 100,000 years ago, and now you're back to the same old fallacy, that now he's somebody's ethnic group, he's somebody's race, we can claim him. This was the big trick that many of the Jewish scholars played on the majority of the world, that all of the prophets were Jewish, except for Muhammad. That's why they hated Muhammad, because he was from the Arabs. So that must make the Arabs very special. That's the Arab speaking, the Arab scholarship speaking. That must make the Muhammad, you mean to tell me Allah would send every prophet from the Jewish people and then the last one would come from the Arab? What's going on in the rest of the world? You know what I would feel like if you told me that? I would feel like the Africans and the Asians, the rest of the Asians, they don't need prophets. They must be good to go. If Allah keeps sending that kind of assistance from a particular people, it means that people must have been really messed up.
Can I comment on the points that your sister made, please?
Yeah.
So she was talking about Nava as well as Rasul. Now, here's something that we do in the gematria, which is mathematics. Mm-hmm. You can take the same words and reverse them. So I want you to see what's going on here with the word. Naba, okay? Now go A-B-N. What is ben? Ben means to be put forth with established principles. So when someone says this person is the son, which is the lesser use of the word, this is my son. You can say Ibn. Mm-hmm. And Ib is the heart. So we're not focusing on that, but it is the heart.
Right.
The love. We're back to that again. And you take Rasul, drop the vowels, and go LSR. What word in English do we have? L-E-S-S-E-R. Lesser.
That's right.
So the mate, the office of Nabi and the office of Rasul. Rasuls don't have to be a Nabi. They're lesser, and in their role and function, they are not to alter nor ever change the message. It's a continuous flow,
yes,
unless Allah deems it necessary to bring forth another Nabi. So Nabis and the other words associated with Nabis would be prognosticate, prophesy, and predict. These are the letters in Arabic-speaking countries. These root letters, MBA, is in the title of the guy who's the weatherman. It's in the title of the National Basketball Association. So what are those guys doing on the floor? They're predicting, projecting. I think I can make that shot from this corner. But he's got enough skill to make that analysis. So what did he say to the Mal'ikatan and Surah Al-Baqarah? He said to them, using the root letters NBA, he said, Anbu'uni.
Yes, that's the word.
So he said, prophesy, predict. Mm-hmm. Give me the characteristic. Give me the science of this. And they said, we can't do it. We only know what you've taught us. And then he brings out the man and he said, Anbu'uni. And the man did it. And then they said, in humility, and submission of their egos, if they had one, to say, for surely you're the Lord, nor of all, okay? And Allah says, did I not tell you that I knew the secrets
of the
heavens and the earth?
Heavens and the earth, the seen and
right.
the unseen.
So, and this is the same group who asked the question, will thou place therein one who will cause mischief and bloodshed? Now, keep this in mind with this conversation. If the Mal'ikatan only knows what Allah has taught them, in order for them to phrase the question that way, will you place therein one who would cause much mischief and bloodshed? That means they've seen it before.
You got them.
They don't talk about Mal'ikatan, nowhere where Allah is referring to any of them. They don't talk about things that they have no knowledge of. So now they have to step back and wait to see What's Allah's grand plan? And Allah did not create man to shed blood. He told us that that was not the purpose. All mm-hmm. the things that he has done, he was pleased with what he's done.
Mm-hmm.
I hope I was able to shine a little bit light, my sister, on your question.
So one of the things that popped up in your conversation right now is that is the idea of office and the idea of job, which they're two different things.
Mm-hmm.
And they both have a mission, but somehow we need to, or we don't need to, but I want to make the, we've been told that, and you said it also, that not all messengers or prophets.
Not all messengers are prophets. That's what I was
right.
saying.
Not all messengers are prophets.
Right.
So I don't know that we've ever been totally clear about the distinction between messengers and prophets. Some have a book, some do not. But if right. we're talking in terms of the job itself, the mission itself,
right,
you know, how do we make that distinction?
Well, they gave it to you a little bit this way in the New Testament, my sister. They don't use the term messengers. They said disciples.
Yes.
And the disciples take the word of Isa, okay? This is what they were supposed to do. And he said, do everything you see him doing, you go and you do this. You heal the people. You cure them. You teach them. You uplift them. You edify them. See, so that's how they got away with not using the term, these guys are rasuls. If you go back before in Quran, you see Allah refers to them as helpers in training. Yes. It's almost like military structure and government structure. And I must say this, the prophet had a millet, right?
Yes.
You remember that, right?
Yes.
That's where the English word military comes from.
Yes. Yes.
Which means a creed and a practice. And so my having been in the military as an officer myself, I know that the generals were the ones who created the operation plan. And then it trickles down eventually to me on my company level when I was a company commander. And I've got what is called the operation order. And I have very limited space to wiggle. I have enough autonomy to address any unexpected issues and problems that show up to neutralize that issue. However, I'm not the one who created the operation plan, and not everyone has the same operation order. This is your Rasul's. So the prophet has the operation plan given to him by Allah, okay? And those who is his close companions, those who are down for the cause and who have no intentions of altering the plan, they're giving their specific operation orders, which is, explains how they went out into the seven areas back to their own people in their own dialect of the Arabic or Shemitic that they were speaking without altering the message, which is the operation plan, but they had their marching orders from the prophet. And then they trained others to continue to do what it was he instructed them to do.
Yeah.
Okay, and so I think that it might have been in Surat Ali Imran where prophet or messenger, I can't remember. I would have to go back and search it out. Asked who would be, my impression is that they would ask who would be your messengers, which would be helpers. Right. And I don't know, I don't recall what the Arabic word
Ansar
was in that.
Ansar.
In that specific instance. Ansar. What was it?
Ansar. Allah.
Oh, okay. Okay. Helpers.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. So, oh, Okay, so actually we have a number of different offices, jobs.
That is correct. You've got the right understanding, sister. There's nothing wrong with anything you said. It's okay. More or less these platforms that Brother Instructor Benjamin Bilal has and some of the other platforms, and then they're bringing people like myself in who have been, either we know other people or we've been studying on our own with the right tools. See, here's how it works. In order to receive this level of help and you share, because we're here to edify one another. There's no big I, little you. That Allah doesn't deal with none of that. He's not the respect of a person that way. You want to get his respect? You want to get his protection? Do the right thing. That's what he's telling us. Do the right thing. And so within these levels of offices, think about even with the revelation of Quran, 100 recorders. And of the 100 recorders, you had 4 that he identified. If you wish to learn Quran, go learn it from these 4. So if you want to think of it in a lesser term, like successor, without the term them being called Rasul, okay, then you could think of it that way. But after him, he in his own heart could rest assured and was rest assured that those that he tested himself and they were groomed to continue to do it in the same style and fashion he did can be considered successors without the label of Nabi. They followed his lead, which is why they were so successful.
Remember also that in the military, in making a connection between the Millah, first and foremost of Ibrahim, according to the Quran, that we follow yes. Millah to Ibrahim. I don't think that term Millah is given in reference to Muhammad. I'm not sure, but I know for sure that it's given in reference to Ibrahim.
Yes.
And you mentioned Millah being where we get the English term military. That's brilliant. That's very observant of you. And remember also that the proper behavior in the presence of a superior military officer is that you get up and do what when he enters the room?
Salute.
That's
which
right.
Is, came from the word salat.
There you go. So if you want to know what salat is, it's going to be in my new book.
Right.
It's going to be ready in a couple of days.
When you render a salute, you're saying, I mean you no harm. And so when you render that salute, he sees that your weapon-bearing hand, your arm,
that's right,
is free of weapons. And that's now right. He can speak to you freely, but you still have to talk to him respectfully.
That's
and
right.
Because we're speaking English, we cannot see the respect built into the Arabia and other indigenous languages on the planet. So you know when an elder is talking to someone younger than them, even if that person is 100 years old and they're talking to someone who's 60 years old, that person yes. is still, so when, even in Cherokee, we do the same thing. So we're mm-hmm. using a form of salute, but we say, CO, CO. Mm-hmm. And then we say, Tawhiju, which is the Arabic word tahajid, which means Allah is drawn, is already drawn close. In my state of mind, I'm in the zone where I'm supposed. That's why in Cherokee we ask you, Osio, Tawhiju. And then the plural, which is like the Arabic, Nehina, Tawhigu. Are we all connected to Allah, the Creator? And so the word Allah is all in the Cherokee language, like all the other indigenous languages here as well. Allah Tuna, Tallahassee, Alabama.
That's right.
And so it's so there was so in order, as you said, instructor of Benjamin Bilal, when you was talking about when they're missing that component, which is the soul force, and you have of the nefesh, you have 2 you're operating from. And you don't have the ruh, and the evidence is in Quran, I'm going to create a new type of man who's, and we're going to be connected to him. And he says, so Allah breathed into him ruh and gave him zalzalin, masnoon. Zalzalin is the Shemitic word, Arabic word for telephone. So you can ring Allah up from the bashir, the flesh that he gave you. You just call him up.
That's right.
And he says, like he told the Prophet, he said, when any of my servants ask of me, he near. Said, I am near. He yeah. didn't tell him to say right. he is near.
I
he
answer said, the call I am near. Of every caller when he calls. That's right.
Yeah. They put so in the there, word zalzal means yeah. telephone is ringing. Isn't that interesting?
Oh. Very.
Well, thank you both. I have lots more to think about now.
Well, sister, you're on the right track. All and right. we are here to edify each other. And there are things that you have said and the questions that you have posed and some of your analysis that you have, it's still on point. Some of the things that we can explain a little better to one another, that's what we're here for. Right. We'll say, yeah, well, take that word and then flip it around. What do you mean flip it around? Well, there's a mathematical science also to these languages that is no longer taught to us. So now we're no different than the people in the so-called Middle East speaking Arabic, but they speak Arabic, but where's the science to it? Do you really know what you're saying? Because there were rules to how you formed words, and certain letter consonants should never ever be put together in one word unless you're trying to bring about something that was seriously destructive.
Mm. Yeah, it's like chemical composition.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. All right. So listen, folks, we have about time for maybe two other short comments or questions. So if I don't hear from you in the next 10 seconds, then that's my clue to wrap it all up. That's my clue. Going once, going twice.
Salam alaikum.
Tanya, alaikum salam. Yeah,
sorry, bad lighting. Can't get it right. Sorry. Just going back. It's just more of confirmation or clarification, basically. Going back to the involution, evolution, it just brought back some notes that I'd had from that had come to me in regards to like as a conceptual, like foundational kind of base of understanding, is the premise of breathing, like with inhaling and exhaling. And what my mind kind of went into discovering with that is the premise of in the duality of things, there's in the inhaling is the in and the down, and then exhaling is the up and the out, and align that with the seed being the in, the root being the down, the plant being the up, and the fruit being the out. And basically that premise of understanding being applicable to different aspects of life, growth and progression and development, basically. If I've said enough and you understand that.
Absolutely. That's one of the ways that the soil breathes.
Yeah.
We get it. You catching a lot of you out there, you catching on. This is beautiful. We don't have to spend as much time. Did you hear the two words?
Inhale and exhale. Mm-hmm.
I want to comment on it, but I know where it's going to take us.
IN and the EX. Go with the HALE. Inhale. Mm-hmm. Okay. So what is the big distinction, the difference between us and those who are considered the shaitan, and especially a lot amongst the jinn? They inhale, they exhale, they don't inhale. That's on a meta spiritual plane. And the one who says that he shall be like Allah, his name is Hillel. You see the connection? Yeah. He's only doing one thing. He's breathing out like the trees. But what is he taking in, guidance and energy wise, from Allah? What's he taking in? Allah's not giving him any, he's not being fed.
Great point.
But he made us, and we're fed from both ends. We inhale and we exhale.
In that as well, I just want to just add what I found interesting in connection to that is if you actually look at the heart and the blood flow, the way the blood flows, you can see it actually goes into the chambers and it goes down and up. It's on that same concept of in, down, up and out.
Same thing for the lungs.
Yeah.
Same thing for the information that comes into the brain. We'll talk about that on a different day. But listen, yeah. I'm sitting here with this Kool-Aid smile on my face because I am so happy and proud, if I can use that word, of what I'm hearing coming from those of you who have opened up to speak to us. It represents a giant leap forward for us, whether you guys realize that or not. It's a giant leap forward. I saw Abdul Alim's hand up. I don't know if he had to bow out, but when I asked to speak, there are some people who, out of respect, they don't just open up and talk. They raise their hands. He had a little mechanical hand raised. I see him back in the queue now. So we're going to end it with a last comment from him.
Salaam alaikum.
Alaikum salam.
Yeah, brother. Thank you for giving me the opportunities here. So what I'm trying to connect, you know, the Ra, the first letter, Rasul, Ra and Sin and Lam. So Sin and Lam, whatever the meaning is, so if we replace the Ra with from starting the Ba, so it come Basal. So if we replace the Ha, Ra with the Ha, so it become Hassle. If we replace with the Wa, so it become Wassel. So it's whatever the meaning is. So Ra is the movement or repeating. Yes. Something like that. And the La is the communication. Yes. And whatever the meaning is seen is, so Allah said that he made the Rasul among the Nafs. So who we are the Nafs, the human soul, right? So whatever, you know, if I have a mosquito bite, even I'm sleeping, so the brain is getting the signal and I am going to touch the mosquito, right? So even I'm sleeping, my hand is going to the, in the right place, right, to save myself. So I have clocked in, it's a coded in my body that all from head to my toes, it's a communication inside of myself. Mm-hmm. And I'm communicating with my son and daughter and family and the community, and even, you know, in the cosmic connection, right? So it's the movement of the language of the soul. So I'm thinking in this way. So in whatever I am doing, every Rasul is going to be asked the question, right? So it's not, you know, it's not in a specific person that I can't say that Muhammad, you know, that you mentioned that Al-Muhammad. So I was thinking about that, and it's very, very, I'm very grateful that I got this answer today. Thank you very much.
One quick second, Brother Benjamin, on Brother Abdul Alim. I love the way you said, replace the R and this. Let's talk about the W. So the Rasul, they rehearse what Allah has sent. They don't change the message. They're not Nabi necessarily, but the person who does not is called wasil. So those are the gossipers, the sneaky people. So you got the person doing the good job and somebody's behind that person's back doing all, saying all the bad stuff. And that's a very ugly word to even for Allah to call somebody that name, waswasil. Wissy-wass, whisperers, is where we get the English word from. And that's my final note, brother.
Let me make one minor correction that in the term wiss-wass, the lamb is not present. What Abdul Alim is pointing to is
right.
The word wassal, which is a part of the grammar. The wassal. So investigate that. U.S. Wisu is from wiss-wass. But no lamb.
Okay.
Yeah. Look in Surah Al-Nas. Yeah. The last surah. Yeah. And you'll find it. You'll find it there. Okay.
I'm sure. Really, but
yeah. So this is what we're here for. This is what we're here for. And especially when we're dealing with the Quran, don't be ashamed or afraid to make corrections, because we didn't author that book.
Don't be afraid to accept the correction.
Yeah. How about that? Yeah, how about that? All right. And it helps all of us to grow when we can just make the on-the-spot corrections. I depend on people like Mahir and even Abdul Alim. I communicate with him almost on a daily basis through email, and he's very quickly coming into his own in terms of his understanding of these consonantal connections in the Arabic language. So I'm going to, when we hang up, I'm going to listen back to this call, to this video, and I'm going to go through every one of the words he established in Arabic and in English, because, you know, Basil is also in the Latin language. You know, they have a saint called Basil or Basil, you know? So right. BSL, yeah, BSL, you know, all of the other connections he gave us.
Right.
Wessel is a very important word. We'll go into that at some other time. But the point is that, as I always say, in the development of all languages, they begin as utterances or sounds, just like newborns make sounds. They make unintelligible, individual sounds. Ah, ah. You know, when they come here, they give a long one. Ah, it's just one long, but it's the same sound. It's the open mouth. So for me, fatha begins the journey towards the language or down the path of language. The fatha, the open mouth sound. It's later on when they begin to make the E sound or the lower I sound, I sound. And then after that, when they learn to go, ooh, ooh, ooh. So that's a developmental progress in pronunciation within the human mouth, that ah, I, ooh. Those are developmental progressions in language. But they also have connections to the human psyche in what they mean, because that ah, that primal scream or that primal cry that the infant makes when it's born, represents being open. I'm open now. I'm naked here outside of a place where I had comfort and warmth. I'm open now. I'm vulnerable. See? So when you understand that the ah sound as the open aleph sound has to do with being open and vulnerable, now you can connect that psychological message to words in the Quran that stress the open A, like al-fatiha, fataha. In fact, most of the verbal root forms have that ah sound connected to them. Okay, I don't know who's I'm echoing now for some reason, so I need to mute folks. Phones out.
Assalamu alaikum, would you clarify that word wasl? Spell that for me, please, because only thing I can think of is a vessel.
I'll give you the English phonetics, but I'm not going to clarify it because, number one, I know you can look it up on your own. Number two, it's going to open up a whole nother discussion. Now he knows what I'm talking about. So okay. It would be the wa, the W.
Well.
The sod.
Okay.
S sound and the lam.
Okay.
Okay. Now, one other thing that got sparked in me when Mahir was explaining to you, Winona, what he was breaking down in terms of the language. And that is that he was talking about Iblis, and he was focusing on the lam and the seen in the word Iblis. There's actually bait or B, lam, seen, BLS, as the folks in New York would say, is their favorite radio station, FM, WBL.
Oh my.
And it's put all the way at the end of the right side of the dial, isn't it? Yeah, that's what Iblis is. Yeah, that's what Balasa is. Now, I was born and raised in New York. I know what I'm talking about, right? Yeah, a lot of gin music coming from that end of the dial, isn't it? Yeah. Now, I just want to sex you up. Yeah, okay. All right. All of that stuff. Our music. I don't claim it. Their music. Now, the point is that because the language begins as a series of single utterances and grows to become what they call biconsonantal or two-letter roots. Two-letter roots are not just called root words. They're called proto-root words. Proto means that it happened before the actual three-letter roots were established. So every Arabic word that is now a triconsonantal word, like balasa, began as a biconsonantal word that can either be, and here's where Mahir's genius comes in again. He spoke about, he didn't use this word, but this is what he meant, the inversion of letters. The inverting, pardon me, of letters. So just like Iblis is a combination of ba, la, sa. If I said it backwards, it would be sa, la, ba, which gives you other Arabic words to work with. One of them means to crucify in the case of Isa. right? Salaba, that's crucifixion, right? So if you break that word in half, here's the genius of this language. Now, you break that word in half, now I can come from the Beit Lam sides of words in Arabic and in English, or I can come from the Lam Seen side of words that begin with L and end with S, like loser. You want to know who Iblis is? Just keep connecting these consonants. Less, I think Mahia mentioned the word lesser earlier, right? So lesser, loser, less, lease. If I'm leasing out my vehicle, I better be careful how I drive it. Loose. What does Allah say? Well, also in al insana la fi khusr, by the setting sun, surely humanity is in loss. Loss, L-S. So all of these L-S's are actually the opposite, the polar opposite of the S-L's, which gives you the English word soul, right?
Owsie.
Gives you the Latin word for sun, S-O-L, soul, right? Gives you the word salihat, which means the coming together of natural relationships, right? Wa'amilu salihat, good deeds that reconcile. See, reconcile, sile, S-L sound. It's planted into 95% of the English language, but people don't know that. They think this thing came out of, from the Jews and their ingenuity. That language, English language, came out of the Hebrew language and all of that. No, when in reality, some of it did, a lot of it did, but a lot of it can be traced right back to the Arabic language. But you have to understand the Arabic language not as that which was established by the people you see today as the typical Arab, because Arab is not a nationality. The Afro-Asiatic languages are Shemitic, as my brother would pronounce it, Shemitic languages. They're not Jewish languages. So we have to redirect our people's brains away from the worship of people. As Allah says, they love to be applauded for that which they have not done. The Quran tells you that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they love to be lauded over for things that they didn't even do. Mm-hmm. All languages came from us. Says who? First of all, where did you come from? You, the Arabs and the Jews, historically speaking, subverted other people's culture and took their names. The Jews over there in so-called Israel, they ain't no biblical Jew. And the Arabs over there in Arabia, those are not historical Arabs, those are Turks. But there's a lot to say about all of that that can't be said, obviously, in the next couple of minutes. I just want to whet your appetites for what's happening and will happen in semester number 22. So we're living in a day and time when everything, I hope that wasn't a reaction to my comments, whoever that was yawning like that. But we're living in a day and time when everything is beginning to settle. You know, when you bury a body in the ground, they say don't put, you know, gravestones or whatever on the thing. Don't do that right away. They say wait a few weeks because the ground needs to settle. So Allah has been masterfully putting a whole lot of foolishness to sleep. You know what that means for an animal, to put it to sleep. But we have to now wait for the ground to settle. That's what we're waiting on right now. Imam Muhammad called it a day in the judgment. He never said this was the judgment day. And I think Mahir spoke to that also. I'm just giving it terms that Imam Muhammad would have given it, right? That these episodes come so often in history. They happen over and over again in history under different circumstances, different people, different times, different emphasis, you know, that are being made when these things happen. But we happen to be living in what both scriptures are calling the conclusion of time. Now, whether that conclusion takes another million years, that's up to Allah, I don't know. All I know is that a lot of the signs of it are here. You understand? And if it doesn't, I'm not worried about whether this is the big one, as Jackie Gleason would call it, you know, the big one, you know, or not Jackie Gleason, Fred Sanford. This is the big one, Wheezy. Not Wheezy, I keep getting these characters mixed, but you know what I'm talking about. I'm coming to join you, honey. No, that ain't what I think this is. I think this day is so magnificent that for you to become depressed and despondent and filled with terror right now, you are a fool. Now, you can weep and moan about other people in your family or your friends or at the masjid or at the church who are going through what they're going through. But I'm telling you, this human in this time has been empowered
with that ruh that we're talking about, that Allah said, wait until I have breathed into him nafakhatu of my, not any, my ruh. That's Allah. Whenever Allah speaks in the first person, is for one of two reasons. He loves the people he's talking about, or he's condemning the people that he's talking about. And he wasn't condemning the Khalifa. It's just that the people who saw us as being black mud fashioned into shape, they couldn't accept that this newly revived message and spirit is coming from people who are black mud fashioned into shape.
By the way, Brother Bilal, word in Surah Al-Araf, when he who spoke out is running his mouth, speaking out from his heart, heart, he says this, you created me from nar, right? Mm-hmm. He says, but him, he said, tawny, right? Where the English word tiny comes from.
Mm-hmm.
He said, ana minhu khairun. He said, I'm bountiful. I bring you results.
Mm-hmm.
I know what I'm doing here. Him, he's tiny compared to me. He's not really, he wasn't even discussing color. He said, he's nothing compared to me. So you sat him in a chair, strapped him in, and infused the knowledge in him to the extent that he violently shook.
You created him. You created
a smart
him.
Guy. So this is Iblis running his mouth. He's supposed to be a smart guy now. He's smart because you pumped it all in him. You know, he says, come on, give me a break. Yeah. This guy is tiny compared to me.
Mintini.
Mintini. And the English word tiny is from that word.
I gotta go, man.
Okay.
If I go back and forth, I'm gonna be here another hour. Yeah, alhamdulillah. We say alhamdulillah for all of the participation tonight, but we gotta go. I haven't even eaten dinner. I haven't even packed my house. But it's a wonderful thing.
Indeed.
All right. No more questions. I gave y'all ample time to ask questions. So
salaamu alaikum.
Waliyuddin.
Yes, salaamu alaikum.
Alaikum salaam.
Just greeting. Everything is great.
Wonderful. And you can have some great news probably next time we talk to you, right?
Oh, yeah. I'm ready for it.
All right.
Okay.
Okay. So thank you for all of the participants, Winona especially, and Mahir especially. I thank you from the bottom of my heart. I don't know if that's a good saying or not. We'll see you all at this time in this special place, this time next week, be on time, because we're going to start on time. And our theme is going to be centered back on nunetic meanings for Quranic words. That's the most important topic that we can discuss now. Again, information related to the direct words of Imam W.D. Muhammad and his tafsir are going to be handled on a different semester, semester number 22, beginning July 1, and on a different website platform to be announced. It won't be on YouTube. You'll get maybe 3 minutes of YouTube, like a commercial, to send you over to the alternate site, which will probably at this point be rumble.com. It's not something you have to sign up for. All you got to do is click the link when I send it to you and share it with other people. We have to build that channel, build a presence on that channel, just like we built a presence on YouTube. On both my YouTube channels, I have close to 2,000 people, but they refuse to pay me. What's that about? They're waiting for me to say something wrong so they can strike me again, so I can start from zero again. But that's not going to happen, because I don't care about their money. I care about getting this message out to all of you. All right. So with that said, I pray that you walk in peace, and that I greet you in the greetings of peace that obligate each and every one of us to keep that peace. Thank you, William Safir, for being a tremendous host week to week to week, and for the presentation you gave. I hope people who missed it will make sure that they don't skip past you to get to me or anybody else, that presentation was spot on. I can't wait to hear it again. So thank you for being the great host that you are, and the great friend that you are of Nunetics and of myself personally. Thank you very much.